Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee. Our next item of business is a roundtable session on grouse muir licensing provision in the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Scotland Bill. Just for the record, I want to say that the committee visited grouse muir on Monday to see the different practices when it comes to trapping to Muirburn, which was of huge help in our deliberations. But this morning, welcome to the meeting. Licensing, and with us this morning we have Robbie Kernahan, the Director of the Green Economy from Nature Scot, Dr. Marnie Lovejoy, Head of Evidence and Environmental Law from the British Association for Shooting and Conservation, Detective Sergeant David Lynn from the National Wildlife Crime, he's the Coordinator for Police Scotland. We've got Ross McLeod, who's the Head of Policy in Scotland for the Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust, Ashley McCann, who's a legal advisor for Scottish Land and Estate, Duncan Orr Ewing, Head of Species and Land Management from RSPB. We have Max Walensky, Campaign Manager from Revive. And remotely, we have Jamie Whittle, who's a committee member for the Rural Affairs Subcommittee from the Law Society of Scotland. We've got Ian Thompson. My apologies. Good. Welcome, Ian. So we've got approximately. Well, first of all, can I say to Jamie, if you wish to add to the conversation, if you put an R in your request to speak box, and anyone else, if you raise your hand, I will bring you in. Can I say from the outset that you don't have to respond to every single question, and if someone said something that you agree with, probably given the time constraints, if you just say that rather than going over the question again. I'll kick off with the first question before going round the table, and it's probably one that most will want to answer. So it's a simple question. Do you agree that licensing is a proportionate response to the issues identified by the Werity Review? And can it resolve the issues about raptor persecution? And if not, what are the alternatives? Who would like to kick off? Well, I'm going to pick someone. Ian Thompson.
Thank you, convener. RSPB Scotland has been campaigning for licensing of the grouse shooting industry for at least a decade. We have a long history of involvement in assisting statutory agencies, particularly the police, in the investigation of wildlife crime cases. For the last 25, 30 years, we have been the only body that has collated and published the figures of raptor persecution on a UK-wide basis. Obviously, over the last 10 years, the Scottish Government has been publishing similar figures to ourselves. The situation is very clear. Raptor persecution has been a persistent problem, and there is an overwhelming weight of scientific evidence, witness evidence, the results of police investigations that links the majority of raptor persecution crimes with the grouse shooting industry. Successive Scottish governments have taken various steps since devolution to try to bear down on the problem: vicarious liability, pesticide disposal schemes, introduction of the facility for Nature Scot to revoke general licences. And while those steps have all been welcome, raptor persecution continues. And so, yes, we feel very strongly that this is both proportionate and a necessary step.
Dr. Lovejoy.
Yeah, thank you very much. The same body of evidence Ian mentioned from the RSPB also shows that between 2007 and 2021, the raptor persecution or illegal killing of raptor has decreased by nearly 75%. So this is a massive progress. the illegal killing of raptors is fully covered by Scots law, by the Wildlife and Countryside Act, and we therefore don't think that it is necessary that we introduce further regulations or a licensing framework.
Ashley.
Endorse what Dr. Lovejoy has said. I've got a great deal of respect for the work that Ian and his team do at the RSPB, but the reality is that the successive measures that the Scottish Government have introduced to tackle this issue have done their job. But putting the question of necessity to one side, the other part of your question, Convener, related to the proportionality of licensing. And in assessing proportionality, the law requires there to be a rational connection between the content and the design of the licensing scheme and its aim, which, as you allude to in your question, is to tackle raptor persecution. The scheme that's proposed in this bill fails on that rational connection test because it goes much further than is needed to tackle raptor persecution. It allows Nature Scot to refuse licences, to take licences away for an unlimited time for conduct that's got nothing to do with raptor crime, not let alone crime at all. You know, it allows Nature Scot to remove licences for conduct that's less than criminal. So putting it in plain terms, SLE's position is that this bill goes much further than is needed to tackle a problem of raptor persecution on grouse moors to the extent that there is one. That makes it bad law, and bad law leads to unintended consequences. So I think it's incumbent on the committee to consider narrowing the scope of this licensing regime to address that.
Ian, before I bring you back in, Ariane Burgess has got a supplementary.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just wanted to pick up on the numbers, the apparent decline, but the figures that we have in our papers that were provided by Police Scotland show that there's 88 offences over those 5 years. And I'd be interested to hear, Ashley, do you consider 88 offences to be a small number, or do you have other evidence to show that raptor persecution is really in decline? I mean, 88 offences is 88 offences. That's 88 killed raptors.
Can I ask, Ariane, I don't have the benefit of the statistics that you've got in front of you, but do those say that the evidence points to them all being committed on grouse moors? Because I think what's lost in this debate is that raptor crime, like every other form of crime, is not committed by one single class of people for one single motivation. So, for example, if you look at the official Wildlife Crime in Scotland report, the very latest one that was published, I think that's for 2020 to 2021, there were 12 raptor crime incidents. That's not prosecution, that's recorded reports to the police that have been investigated. The majority of them related to incidents in Dumfries and Galloway, and there are no grouse moors in Dumfries and Galloway. So I think it's really important to contextualise these numbers and not allocate all incidents to one land use. That would be wrong.
Ian Thompson.
It's very easy to focus in on absolute numbers of bodies that were found. What I would say is the people who are committing crimes against raptors are not wanting to be caught. These crimes are taking place in some of the remotest areas of Scotland, where witnesses are few and far between, where evidence is easily disposed of. We've found, for example, satellite tags wrapped in metal thrown into rivers. We've found bodies buried on the ground. What I would suggest is, and I think Professor Newton mentioned in his evidence last week, that the crimes that are actually being uncovered represent very much the tip of an iceberg. What is a much clearer indication of whether raptor persecution is truly declining or not are the populations of birds of prey on our grouse moors. And species like hen harrier and peregrine continue to be largely absent and certainly not continually breeding successfully. And I think that's clearest evidence as anything that raptor persecution continues unabated.
I'm going to bring in Ross McLeod and then Dr. Lovejoy.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to comment on the conservation status of golden eagles, which since 2015, when the latest framework report came out, indicated that they have achieved the threshold of good conservation status at over 500 pairs. And it is the case that in certain circumstances, golden eagle chicks are being translocated to the South of Scotland Golden Eagle Project. And that surely couldn't happen if those populations weren't in robust status to enable that to happen. a degree. There are some patchy information about hen harrier figures, for instance, but there's another framework. I think a framework report is coming out this year. I think we ought to be led by the evidence to see what the situation is with those and other species. But certainly I think the Werribee report has galvanised interest in understanding that raptors are part of a functioning ecosystem, and we've seen considerable change in attitude, which may not yet be feeding through into official statistics.
Dr. Lovejoy.
Yes, I'd like to come back to the point of proportionality. The fact that criminals are hiding their crimes is inherent to them being criminals, isn't it? That isn't unique to wildlife crime, and it's surely not unique to criminal offences that happen on managed grouse moors. That's just a fact. We have a decrease in illegal killing of raptors of nearly 75%, which is a really positive outcome. I don't think that there is any justification to bring in a legal framework and a licensing framework that is so far-reaching and so intrusive as the bill which has been put in front of us. It is so far-reaching, and I'm sure we will come back to the point, for example, of the suspension of a license based on the mere existence of an investigation. But it is so far-reaching that it breaches with the most fundamental procedural guarantees a person should be able to enjoy in a democratic society. And that can't be proportionate, and it can't be right. So if we look at, and Ashley mentioned it, if we look at the quality of law which is proposed here, if we take it out of a very controversial debate on whether we like driven grouse shooting or shooting in general or not, but if we take the bill which was put in front of us out of that context, we all have to agree that it needs work. It is not yet at the stage where it can be implemented into law.
Thank you. Ashley McCann.
I simply endorse that. The points I was going to make have been covered.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Convener. I'm going back to last week's evidence session, and Professor Ian Newton said, as we understand it, the situation that persecution of birds of prey has not declined substantially in the years since the report was written. In fact, during a year with the most lockdown, which was 2020, the rate of killing or the number of cases reported to the RSPB was the highest for this century. In other words, when there were fewer people in the countryside, the level of persecution was certainly increased. I won't go into the figures. I'm aiming this specifically at yourself, Ashley, Maureen and Ross. Do you accept that there is a persecution of raptor problem in this country?
I accept that the crime of raptor persecution is being committed in Scotland. What I don't accept is that it is a problem that is exclusive to grouse moor management. And again, I come back to the point that I made in response to Ariane's question. The deterrent effect of the regulation that has already been brought in has reduced the instances of these crimes on grouse moors to a level that means the Scottish Government has done its job. You know, there are a number of motivations for killing raptors, and as I say, the recent statistics, we can only go on the most authoritative statistics, which are the ones contained in Scotland's wildlife crime supports, suggest that it's not actually happening on grouse moors to any great extent. And I think with respect to Ian, a lot of what he is saying is grounded in suspicion. The sector is effectively being asked to prove the absence of crime. How do you go about that?
Can I ask you, if the evidence that we are hearing states that in the vicinity of grouse moors there is a dearth of breeding pairs of peregrines, hen harriers, etc., is the causal effect anything else other than persecution? Could you give me an example of that?
I'll stay in my lane. I'm not a scientist, but I understand, for example, that some birds of prey are very territorial. So in areas where golden eagles are doing very well, you may not see as many other birds of crime, but there are people who are more well-equipped than me to answer that question. The point I think this comes back to is, does this scheme go further than it needs to address the issue of raptor persecution on grouse moors, if you are right in saying that there is one? And the answer to that is yes, it goes much further than it needs to, and that means this measure, as proposed in the bill, is disproportionate. I think that's a key point.
So Police Scotland are impartial, however, we want to reduce crime across the board, and wildlife crime is no different, so we support the licensing scheme in general terms. I can provide some clarity around some more recent statistics and figures for the committee. So since the publication of the Werriter report in 2019, there have been 11 crimes against birds of prey reported happening on or very near to grouse shooting estates. Of those offences, they've been broken down into 4 poisoning cases, 6 shootings, and 1 muir burn, which resulted in a nest disturbance. So over and above that, so those are crimes that have been recorded. Over and above that, though, there have been 20 suspicious cases where there's been insufficient evidence to conclude that a crime has definitely occurred. Now, I appreciate that suspicion is quite a subjective term, but I think we've been very fair in how we classify a suspicious incident. So it's things like sudden stop, no malfunction, as we call it, of satellite tags. Now, I know Ian will be far more expertise in this area of business than me, but from my knowledge of satellite tags, they will have like a kind of general decline in battery life, or they'll show signs of malfunction usually prior to, you know, stopping to transmit. We're talking about incidents where a satellite tag has literally just stopped transmitting, which we consider to be suspicious. It's birds of prey carcasses that were found by, say, a member of the public, and by the time police officers arrived on the scene, the carcass has been removed, which could suggest someone is potentially covering up their tracks. But again, it's suspicion as opposed to recording a crime. Things like birds of prey carcasses that have been found and we're yet to hear back about forensic results, PMs, toxicology and things like that. So we are of the belief at Police Scotland that raptor persecution is an ongoing issue. Arguments can be made about the extent of that and whether rates are increasing or decreasing, but it's still ongoing, and I think that's key here. And I think you can only, in terms of Dr Lovejoy's point about wildlife crime, it is very different, though, than any other criminality. I appreciate what you're saying about all criminals try and sort of cover up their tracks and things, but wildlife crime is very, very different in the sense that your conventional policing methods, door-to-door, CCTV inquiries, witnesses, we don't have these things with wildlife crime generally. They're happening in very, very rural areas, very hard to detect. And we're potentially, now I appreciate it's the minority of estates that are potentially being involved in this kind of incident, but those that are involved in it, you're talking to people who have got a vast, vast knowledge of their land, of where they can potentially do things that could be out of view of the public. And that's key to remember as well, that it is incredibly difficult to detect. So I think it's widely accepted that the figures we have could be an underrepresentation of what's actually going on.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Dr Lovejoy and then Ross McLeod.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'd like to respond to that directly. All crimes which happen in a rural setting are facing these problems. So that can be crimes committed by farmers, can be related to the use of pesticides, can be related to poaching, for example, can be related to hair coursing. All crimes in this setting are difficult to investigate and difficult to prosecute. However, so this is not limited to what happens on a managed grouse moor. What we have to bear in mind here, the fact that a criminal offence is difficult to investigate, the fact that law enforcement is difficult, doesn't give the state a right to infringe in fundamental procedural guarantees an individual must be able to enjoy in a democratic society. We do have the presumption of innocence. A suspicion is not a criminal offence prosecuted and a person found guilty. And I think we have to be very, very careful with that. If we take that out of context, there would be public outcry if we'd have these provisions in any other criminal offence. If I would suggest that we take a driver's licence away based on a suspicion, it's actually not even a suspicion, it's even if the relevant authority is not satisfied that the criminal offence has been committed, they can suspend the licence. Imagine if we would suspend driver's licence even though we are not satisfied that the driver has committed a criminal offence. It's unthinkable. And the other problem is, if you are highlighting rightly how difficult it is to investigate rural crimes, with all the investigatory power the police has, imagine how difficult it is to disprove such a crime for an individual who has none of these investigatory powers. And I think that's the crux of the problem here. So we are dealing with a bill which is as Ashley mentioned, it's bad law. It is not drafted in a sensible way. It is disproportionate, and it is infringing in rights which we just need to take it out of the context and in the political discourse, and we can all see it has to be worked on.
Yeah, we're still on question one. I'm going to try and bring this to a close. I'm going to bring in Ross, Max, and then Rachel's got a supplementary before moving on to the next question.
Thank you, Convener. The GWCT is a research and education charity, so we're not experts in raptor crime as such, but we do want to see sensible recording. And one of the downstream effects of the Werity report, which mentioned it needed to understand the conservation status of three key species of raptors in or in the vicinity of managed moorland. The effect of that is, for us at least, was to try and establish a basis on which that could be measured, because putting a line around an area of moorland is quite challenging, but we've done that. And the reason for that is that if you look at NatureScot's special heritage zones, they're quite large areas. They cover more than just managed moorland, so we need to be a bit more refined about that. So what the GWCT has established is a series of area transects in different parts of managed moorland in Scotland. And I think the effect of that is twofold. First of all, it's concentrated minds on understanding what is out there. It's performing a useful purpose in that regard, so we understand a little bit more. It has engaged the keepers in understanding exactly what we're recording out there as well. And I think in the longer term, what we're looking to make sure is that data is shared in a safe space with other parties who are interested in collaborating about the conservation status of raptors. So there's a positive aspect that has come out of Werity already, and that's what we are focused on.
I'm going to bring in Max, and then Robbie, I'll bring you in because we haven't heard from you yet.
Thank you, Convener. On the question whether it's proportional and whether it will work, first of all, will it work? We certainly hope so. There's been a wide body of evidence over many years. The pattern of behaviour suggests that, yeah, there is a link between raptor persecution and grouse moor management. And, you know, there have been steps, as the government official said in the first session, that have been taken, which may have had an impact, but certainly hasn't stopped the issue from taking place. So we certainly hope it will work after many years since our very first Minister, Donald Dewar, called the issue a national disgrace. We're still here in 2023 discussing this issue, so we hope it works. And as to whether it's proportionate or not, I mean that's a real question, but we're talking about huge proportions of Scotland's land being managed in many separate ways. The central issue to this is the maximising of grouse numbers here. Now, the Vive is a unique coalition of environmental, animal welfare and social justice organisations which have come together to look at these, to look at grouse moor management, because it unites us in the issues of animal welfare on the issues of environmentalism and social justice, large tracts of land managed so a few people can shoot some grouse. In the situation we're finding ourselves in, we've got sessions looking at this, the trapping of wild animals, hundreds of thousands of animals killed so that more grouse can be shot for sport, versus large tracts of land being burnt so more grouse can be shot for sport, which is at the heart of the issue here. And so it's wholly proportional that as a country, as a government, the government actually actually regulates these huge tracts of land. The very fact it hasn't been regulated up to this point in any significant way is indicative that we need a substantial amount of change. And as for will it work or not, certainly the legislation looks good from where the Revive Coalition is standing in terms of bringing the next step of reform, and we certainly hope it does its intended job of ending raptor persecution.
Okay, Robbie.
Maybe a couple of observations, if I may. Just my main point, I think, is that the primary purpose of this bill to try and address the blight that is raptor persecution in Scotland, we absolutely support. Raptor persecution has no place in modern day Scotland. I think we'd all support that. I think the issue about understanding the statistics. We know that raptor persecution is still occurring, and it is still
related to management of moors for grouse. Now, whilst the official crime statistics might not reflect that accurately, we know there are still unoccupied territories of some of our best raptors in and around grouse moors. So there's ecological data which is helping inform this bill, which doesn't seem to be getting much airtime. And also, in the context of existing licensing frameworks, we've got 5 general license restrictions in place at the moment, based on intelligence from the police, all in and around grouse moors, all to do with trapping offences, shooting and poisoning. So it is still pervasive in Scotland, and I don't want to underplay the significance of it. I think the second point about the ambition within the bill is that it's a mistake to look at this bill just through a raptor persecution lens. We're in a nature and climate crisis, and what we can do with these provisions is up the standards of everybody involved in managing Scotland's uplands for nature and climate, and we'll come on to that, I'm sure, as the discussion continues. But us as a licensing authority, as a regulator, we've been advocates of better regulation ever since we took on licensing functions from Scottish Government, and we can be proportionate and we can be targeted, and we're trying to increase accountability here. And just my final point is that we're not really talking about criminal burdens of proof in this space. We're talking about civil burdens of proof. And we've got lots of experience of that, where we've lost trust and confidence in those operating under licences. We can act accordingly.
OK, and finally, on this opening question, I'm going to bring in Jamie Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of comments, if I may. One of the comments that the Law Society of Scotland made in its consultation responses, both at the end of last year and in May, was that a licensing scheme in of itself may not be the ultimate deterrent, and that it is important to couple it with enforcement and information sharing. A second point I just wanted to make, it was picking up Robbie Kernahan's point a moment ago, is that we obviously sit in this context of climate and biodiversity emergencies, and there is potential further land reform coming through. There has been consultation on that. One of those has been to look at management plans more widely for larger land holdings. And so, and this may come into discussion later on, but it's just to mark that as a point that in terms of drafting law, whenever law can be made clear and consolidated, so much about one of the real challenges of wildlife law in Scotland is that it is very fragmented, and that can lead to complexity and understanding. And so the more that these elements can be dovetailed together, then so much the better. Thank you.
Thank you. Move on to the next question, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if this one perhaps I can address initially to the police and the Law Society, but then anyone else can chip in. And it's about the list of relevant offences which are set out in the legislation we're talking about, for which a Section 16AA licence might be revoked or suspended. Can I ask what you think about that list of offences? Is it too short, too long? What should be in it? Is it workable? Just any. I'll, since you're sitting next to me, David, I'll start with you.
No problem. So, Police Scotland don't really have a massive opinion on the list of relevant offences. I think it is important that anything that's included in that list of relevant offences, I suppose, relates to good grouse moor management. Ultimately, with the list, I believe there are links there in terms of the legislation within the relevant offences that could tie in with grouse moor management. I'm probably not an expert in terms of the kind of links there. But excuse me, I'll just refer to something very quickly. So in terms of these, obviously the likes of the Protection of Badgers Act. So I think there's some indication that likes of badgers and things like the European Protected Species and things could potentially pose a risk to young grouse as they're being kind of raised and released and things. So I think that's part of the thinking behind that, I believe. But obviously Police Scotland weren't involved in including these offences. But I think it's important that, I suppose, they do relate, as I said, to grouse moor management. And as I say, Police Scotland don't really have a massive opinion on that.
I suppose what I'm just driving at here is, you know, I appreciate there's maybe not much you can comment on, but just looking at what's being proposed,
you know, as a police officer,
yeah,
in terms of its workability?
Well, we will investigate these offences regardless, ultimately. So the only difference will be that we would investigate these offences and we would notify Nature Scott of our investigation as it's progressing, and a decision could be made about whether it's proportionate enough to restrict the licence. So it won't really affect Police Scotland as such because, as I say, we will investigate these offences. If one of these is reported to us, one of the relevant offences is reported to the police, we will carry out investigations thoroughly regardless. The only difference will be we notify Police Scott, we notify Nature Scott, apologies, who would then look at whether it's proportionate to restrict licences. I think a lot of it comes down to whether or not the bill's intended to protect wider wildlife and grouse management or specifically kind of raptor persecution.
Can I bring in Rachel for a supplementary on that?
Well, it's just quite an interesting point that you made there around badges. I just wondered if or what evidence that Police Scotland have to suggest that anyone that operates a grouse moor is culpable for the persecution of badgers, for example. Is that included in any data that is included within the raptor persecution data?
Certainly not that I've got at hand at the moment. So obviously, as I say, Police Scotland weren't involved in including these relevant offences.
So you don't agree that is related? Or?
But I believe there could be certain links. I mean, I think, for example, in terms of mammals, there's the Wild Mammals Protection Act. I think I've heard, now I don't know this as a fact, but I've heard there's kind of links between, say, ticks that can be found on mammals that can then pass to grouse and can pass disease and things like that. So
yes,
I think,
but I know all that, mm-hmm. Having worked in the countryside and campaigning against, you know, to protect against ticks, mm-hmm. To stop Lyme disease. But the key point here for us to understand as a committee is the evidential basis that you are saying, well, you're inferring that there's a link here between badger persecution and grouse moors. Is that correct?
Not that I can evidence right now in terms of statistics and figures, but obviously.
But why did you say that?
But obviously, it's been included for a reason. Obviously, as I said, Police Scotland weren't involved in including this legislation, the relevant offences.
Okay.
So I don't know who has included it, but they'd maybe be a better place to discuss why it's been included and the proportionality of that. As I've said, it won't really impact Police Scotland. I think clearly there is a link and it wouldn't be included. I don't think they would just pull this legislation out of nowhere and include it in the bill.
Well, perhaps somebody around the table could.
Yeah. Can I bring in Dr. Lovejoy?
Very much. I'm in the privileged position to work at the interface between law and ecological scientists, so I do have some statistics which might help here. So badgers, they don't tend to live on grouse moors. It's not their preferred habitats. Badgers live in arable land, grassland, woodland, but they don't live on bog and heath. And actually, in 2006, there was a distribution survey, Scottish Badger Distribution Survey, done. And out of the 8 habitat types surveyed, heath and bog was the least preferred by badgers. In terms of figures, per kilometre square, there is 0.019 badger set. So they are simply not there. So there is no link, there is ecologically no link between crimes against badgers and managed grouse moors. Grouse are not released, by the way, so I think there is a little bit of a confusion between reared game birds and wild game birds. But what it shows to us is that parts of this bill is based on stigma rather than reality. The same applies to hunting with dogs. There are no fox hunts on grouse moors.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Just coming back to Alistair Allen's initial question, which was around the list of relevant offences, I'd like to address my question to RSPB Scotland. So RSPB Scotland recommended in written evidence that the list of relevant offences which could result in licensing being suspended should also include offences under the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006. And I'd be interested to hear why you take that view and if you've got any examples that would help us understand it.
Basically, raptor persecution is a symptom quite often of a wider pattern of offending that occurs in some of these intensively managed areas. We agree with the relevant offences included, and we suggested that animal welfare should also feature because, for example, the use of crow traps on intensively managed grouse moors is widespread and often, and we have substantial evidence that we've passed to Nature Scot and police in the past that shows that a significant number of these traps are misused or abused, in other words, contrary to the terms and conditions in the general licence. And often those offences include the suffering of animals, hence the animal welfare provisions. Grouse moor management entails a significant amount of predator control. As most of that, I think we acknowledge, is legal. Whether that the scale of that predator control is suitable during a biodiversity crisis is perhaps not for the scope of this bill. But inevitably, unfortunately, there are also misuse of traps and snares as part of this. So I think having as wide scope a range of offences that will tackle the pattern of offences that isn't just restricted to raptor persecution is entirely appropriate.
I can bring in Robbie and then Ashley.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Allen's response, I think from my perspective,
again, when you think about how land management takes place in reality, grouse moors don't operate in isolation. They operate as part of an estate, which will have integrated uses for farming, for forestry, for agriculture. Quite a lot of the wildlife management is undertaken by the same staff, so whilst farmers might not be a significant issue on grouse moors in themselves, quite a lot of the management activity will be around integrated land use. And from our perspective as a regulator, if we've lost trust that anybody can comply with the Badgers Act or the Wildlife and Countryside Act or the habitat regs, we have to ask ourselves the question, are these the kind of people we want to issue licences to for all of those purposes? So I think it's really important that we look at the context of what's happening in the round and not just through, again, a lens of raptor persecution.
Ashley.
Thank you. I think what the wide scope of relevant offences in this bill does is effectively say grouse moor operators are being held to a much higher standard in law than any other type of land manager. It has discriminatory effects. Now, if you're going to interfere with rights that have got a huge economic value, that support jobs, that are essential to operating a business, then you need to have a good reason, a good evidence-led reason for that interference. There is absolutely no evidence that the wide range of offences that don't cause harm to raptors included in this bill are occurring at any higher rate on grouse moors than in any other land management context. The desirability for an additional deterrent for these crimes is not enough to interfere with rights. It needs to be evidence-based. These crimes are already covered by the law. They're already covered by really punitive civil criminal sanctions, as well as Robbie has alluded to, the ability to remove general licences. The effect of this bill would be to say, you know, if you commit a crime under the let's say, the conservation legislation referred to on a farm, you will continue to be able to operate your farm. You will have the benefit of only suffering a penalty if your guilt has been proved beyond reasonable doubt. 2 miles down the road in a grouse moor, completely different story. You can have your licence taken away without any proof to any standard of your guilt. You know, Robbie talked about the civil standard of proof being what underpins this bill. It's patently not. The bill says in terms that licences can be suspended for an unlimited time where the regulator is not satisfied. What that means is that there is no proof whatsoever. That's draconian.
Okay, Jamie Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. I was going to say that if the focus of the bill is much more on raptor persecution, then my thought is that in the interests of fairness, it's important to make sure that the relevant offences are focused on that end point. However, if, as I mentioned in my last set of comments, that there was, say, a wider contextual aim set against, you know, wider legislation of looking at biodiversity issues more generally across the countryside, then I can see much more how that wider set of relevant offences and pieces of legislation could fit into that context more easily. But there is a danger, I would suggest, that of there not being fairness if there is a different level of treatment that is being applied to grouse moors versus the wider countryside, and that just needs to be taken into consideration.
Right. Supplementary.
On this
Jamie,
point.
Well, it was just on the lowering the standard of proof. Would that, Jamie Whittle, in your opinion, violate any laws under or articles under ECHR?
I haven't considered specifically the human rights position before, so I would need to consult with colleagues at the Law Society, and very happy to respond to the Parliament separately on that. What I would comment on the standard of proof is that the way in which we have read this is that the civil standards, so on the balance of probabilities, would apply to the powers given to Nature Scott when it considers the various options it might have of a warning or a temporary suspension or a revocation. And that would be quite analogous with other licensing regimes where that civil standard of proof has been applied. And I understand it's the same with licensing for other wildlife licensing instances. Separately, aside from perhaps a revocation or a warning by Nature Scott, it may then escalate into a different layer of enforcement where Police Scotland, Crown Office are brought in, and that would be a separate exercise where the criminal standard would come in against the context of Wildlife and Countryside Act, etc. So in answer, I think it does fit.
We are going to come on to HCHR a bit later, but if you've got a very brief comment on this.
Two very brief comments. So first of all, whether we are in the realm of civil law or criminal law in the view of the European Court of Human Rights will be assessed autonomously in the European Court of Human Rights. So just because we call it a civil sanction doesn't mean it is a civil sanction under human rights law. So they will look at, for example, the intrusiveness of the sanction imposed. And I think that brings me to the second point. We have to be very careful to compare this licensing framework to other licensing framework in this sphere. So, for example, the general license framework to control pest birds. To control pest birds is not as important as to get a license to take grouse. So what we are looking at here is a license which effectively determines whether a person can go on with their profession or in their business or not. So we are in a completely other sphere and we are looking at completely different legal interests. So I think that partially answers the question regarding the ECHR, but we'll come back to that.
Ashley, it's very brief.
Just a point of clarification on what Jamie has said. For the avoidance of doubt, we are not talking about the civil standard when we're talking about suspension in relation to Section AAHC, I think it is. We're actually talking about no standard of proof, lower than the civil standard. We're talking about the regulator applying punishment where it's not satisfied, just for the record to clarify okay, that.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
On that point that Ashley McCain raised there about the standard used and the penalties used, and you described that as draconian, I just wonder if you have a view on the fact that Professor Werity gave evidence to our committee and essentially, as far as I can recall him saying, said that he couldn't see another way of dealing with raptor persecution other than a licensing scheme.
A licensing scheme predicated on the civil standard of proof? That's not what we're talking about. The Scottish Government consulted with the public on a licensing scheme that allowed penalties to be opposed, where NatureScot, as the regulator, is satisfied on the balance of probabilities that the crime has occurred. Fine, that is one proposition. That is not what is on the face of this bill. And I think one of my concerns, having listened to the evidence sessions so far, looking at the BRIA, looking at the policy memorandum that underpins this bill, is that there's a real disconnect between what the Scottish Government are saying this bill does and what the black letter of the law actually says. The bill, as proposed, allows licences to be removed where there has been no proof to any standard, not the civil standard. So if we're getting a licensing regime, fine, but let's make sure it is improved so that it's workable, so that we don't lose those benefits to Scotland that Professor Newton talked about last week, you know, in terms of biodiversity, investment, wildfire mitigation, etc. We need procedural safeguards, and that's what I'm really hoping will come out of this discussion today. How do we improve the bill? If licensing is happening, how do we make it workable?
Thank you.
I just want clarification, please. I just want clarification from Nature Scott. You said the licence would be suspended if a crime has been committed. Can I ask, would you use the term crime or just say a breach of the terms of the licence? Because this is important to distinguish between civil and criminal.
So the key principle underlying all of this is on the balance of probability.
I know all about that. I'm asking you, is it, there's been a breach of the terms of the licence, would you use the term crime? Because that seemed to me to move into the area of criminal responsibility, where it's beyond reasonable doubt, etc. So I just want clarification.
Can I maybe stop you there, Christine? I'm going to get Karen to ask this question because it will be covered in her question.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
It's okay, Christine. Thank you, convener. Yeah, I was wanting to dig a bit more into the suspension of licences and what was behind that. And I do note that we have heard that it may be for suspicion, but my understanding of it was when there was an official investigation has started and not just mere suspicion. And just for clarity, the DVLA can revoke or suspend a driver licence when there is an official investigation underway. Yeah, so a driver's licence. So just for clarity on that last point, but it was just to talk a bit more about that and then asking Nature Scott where they feel that they would regard an official investigation underway and feel it's appropriate to suspend a licence.
So again, just to try and provide some reassurance to members around the table, how I envisage this working in practice, and our experience to date tells us as proponents of better regulation, we will make interventions based on the best level of information we've got in front of us, and that needs to be robust, otherwise we will be challenged. I can never envisage a situation where we will suspend a licence based on no evidence. No, I, again, in constructing a framework of how this will work in practice, as we did for general licence restrictions, we will work with stakeholders to say, this is the type of evidence we will consider, these are the type of circumstances we will consider suspension or revocation or modification. We will not construct a licensing framework which we are not comfortable will withstand scrutiny. And having done the same for general licences, when we constructed this framework, we were taken to judicial review. The process which we put in place about robust evidence, about an appeals mechanism, about the right for people to be heard and the right to respond based on our assessment of the evidence, all withstood scrutiny. And I cannot envisage a situation where we would not try and replicate that through this bill.
Thank you. And would I be able to ask Police Scotland, Detective Sergeant Lynn, what would you, could you clarify what you would deem as an official investigation?
I've heard some different points made about this, about whether it's the point at which someone contacts the police, if that's an official investigation underway. I suppose it entirely depends on the incident itself and how it unfolds, because very quickly you could identify there is no crime, so therefore there is technically no investigation. You could identify that very quickly. You could even potentially identify that based on the text of a call from a member of the public on receiving an incident, reviewing it, thinking there doesn't appear to be any criminality here, going out and very quickly establishing that. So it's difficult to give an answer, a hypothetical answer, because every situation is very different. Mm-hmm. However, that does often happen. An incident is discovered there's no criminality very early on, in which case a full-blown investigation doesn't really commence. Whereas that very well could be the point where an investigation commences when someone contacts the police, and it obviously goes from there.
So just to clarify, there would have to be evidence of criminality before an official investigation was launched.
Well, you can carry out an investigation. No, not entirely, because you can carry out an investigation and criminality can come to light during that. Or okay. At some point you could realise there is no criminality. So it might not happen at that immediate point in time. Okay. It could happen initially when the call comes in. It could happen a few hours, a few days.
Okay.
It depends entirely. Again, it's hypothetical, so it's very difficult to answer considering the wide range of calls we deal with.
Mm-hmm.
But at any point, you could establish criminality, and that's, I suppose, the purpose of an investigation, to establish criminality and to deal with it thereafter.
Okay, thank you.
Is there such a thing as an unofficial investigation?
No, not really, because everything's recorded. Everything's on systems. As soon as someone contacts the police, there's an incident which needs to be updated and disposed of accordingly. So that needs to be disposed of. We work under the Scottish Crime Recording Standards. So basically, we need to write off incidents as such when someone contacts the police to report something. Now, whether that be a crime report has been raised and established, or there's no criminality, or for example, in maybe child protection matters, social work will be moving forward with this, so you can write off incidents in different ways. So technically there is no such thing as an unofficial investigation, because once someone contacts police, there is a paper trail there that needs to be finalised.
So immediately someone contacts the police with a complaint which involves some sort of criminality, and an allegation of criminality, that is then an official investigation?
Yes, technically yes, because it needs to be resolved in one way or another. Now, it could be, as I said, it could be very, very quickly that that is established, there's no criminality, in which case it would be an incredibly short investigation.
So, but there's no timescales to an official, you're suggesting?
No, as I say,
if it's very quick or very long,
it could happen very quickly, it could take time to establish whether there's criminality or not.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Lovejoy.
Thank you very much. I think this discussion highlights exactly what is wrong with this bill. So if you read the letter of the law, it clearly says that a licence can be suspended, unlimited in time, even though the relevant authority is not satisfied that a criminal offence has been committed, if there is an official investigation. And we heard that in some cases an official investigation is as much as a phone call to the police. This is exactly the problem of this bill. And with all due respect, for people affected, it's simply not enough to get an informal reassurance from Nature Scott, which says, well, yeah, but we won't apply it in that way. We will be much more pragmatic. You might be much more pragmatic, but the certainty in law which we require has to reflect that. That's how laws should work in a democratic society. And that is why that needs to be worked on. And I just want to add one point, if I may. The problem with an official investigation is that we are operating in a sphere which is very highly politicized. And there are, unfortunately, incidences where people who are opposed to driven grouse shooting are meddling with traps, are meddling with snares, and are staging evidence to show that there might be a criminal offense where there isn't. And I just want to highlight one figure. In 2014, the Scottish Government has commissioned Basque to conduct a study on how many incidences of meddling with traps and snares and vandalism they can record. So we got, in only 1 year, recording of 193 traps and snares being meddled with. So the fact that someone opposing this can call the police, start an official investigation, is a reality. It's not a hypothesis.
Okay, thank you. I've got Rachel Hamilton, a supplementary on this.
It's all been covered, thank you. But I would like to, that part, but I would like to press David Lynn on the sort of definition of an official investigation. So if, as has happened, because we heard it on Monday, a gamekeeper walks into the police station with a dead raptor, what happens at that point? Because does that become an official investigation?
Yes. Sorry.
Well, because what is the process? Because there was the police deemed that there was no criminal activity at that point. There was no official investigation. Is it inconsistent, approach?
There wouldn't necessarily... Suspicion wouldn't necessarily fall on the gamekeeper in that case. However,
there was no toxicology.
It's different. Well, again, I was about to come to that. It's difficult, again, to speak about these situations, having no experience with the incident itself, because there could have been decisions made behind the scenes that I'm unaware of. I would probably expect, there could have been reasons not to go down this route, but I would expect that there would be a post-mortem or some sort of toxicology if a raptor's found with kind of no obvious indication of the reason of death.
Well, there wasn't in that case, okay. But...
I think we've established that an investigation is an investigation, whether it's official or not. I want to move on. I'm going to bring in Ashley and then Christine for a very, very, very short supplementary. Just to give an indication, we are more than two-thirds through this, and we've got another 10 questions to ask. So we need to keep this the questions and the answers as succinct as possible. So Ashley and then Christine.
Thank you. I'll be brief. One of the points that I think has not been stressed enough is that suspension is not, as the bill team confirmed in evidence, a short-term penalty.
There is nothing in this bill, in the black letter of the law, that limits suspension to, let's say, a period of weeks. Now, what we've heard over and over again, prior to the introduction of this bill, in fact, is that police investigations into wildlife crime, such as raptor persecution, are very difficult and they can become protracted and take a long time to complete. That means the damage caused by suspension in the interim will be permanent. Now, it's all well and good saying that Nature Scot as a regulator will be even-handed in its approach, but the reality is that the ease with which licences can be suspended will mean that this bill has disproportionate effects. It will mean that long-term investment into grouse moor management is no longer an attractive proposition. And I have to say, as someone who works in courts, appeal rights are of very little comfort in that respect. There is no obligation on Nature Scot to share any information with the licence holder in advance of that suspension being imposed. Nor, in fact, is there any obligation to notify the licence holder that they're considering suspension. How, then, are you supposed to challenge that decision in the courts? I think that would be very difficult on a practical level. I don't think that this provision really does provide access to justice. Now, what we heard from Professor Colin Reid last week was that this really is a very, very big step to take, and it is a trigger for suspension that he would imagine Nature Scot would use very, very rarely, if ever, to use his words. My respectful suggestion to the committee would be that the balance weighs in favour of not including it. This scheme already materially adds to Nature Scot's toolbox by providing the civil standard of proof for suspension and revocation. This investigation trigger goes too far.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
I'm completely muddled here about the levels of proof, because we're using the term criminal when we're referring to licensing, which is a civil matter with civil remedies and breaches. So if I just put this proposition to sort of understand what would happen. The licensing scheme is in place. The police receive a report that there has been an incident. They check it out. Let's assume there is absolutely sufficient evidence that a crime has been committed to meet the standard of proof in the criminal courts, and the onus being on the prosecution. I take it you would, do you bypass Nature Scot, simply go to criminal prosecution? Don't answer just now. That's my first one. The second one is, you get a phone call, you do an investigation, you don't think there's sufficient to take it to the PF. So do you then take it to Nature Scot, who then look at what you have and they decide whether or not, on civil balance of probability, to suspend the licence? That's what I'm trying to get into my head, because the word crime is being used in your context and in your context. And I need to know, and I think landowners would need to know as well, how does that work? So there you go. That was quite short.
Robbie, would you like to...
And I appreciate the complexity and the interplay in all of this. And I do think there is a little bit of each case on its merits, in that if there is an investigation starting, we're in fairly regular contact with Police Scotland about the nature of any potential offences. And, of course, we would also look at the context in which that's taking place. So we're not acting in isolation. We will have intelligence and background and history and an understanding of whether or not this most recent investigation continues to remove our trust and confidence that an operator can act with the intention and spirit of how we're issuing licences. So if we have lost trust, and another investigation in context is meaning we've not got confidence, we may well suspend the licence. And we've already got discretion in all of our licensing functions to carry these things out. So this is not new territory. It hasn't been prescribed in law in the way that it is in this bill. But as a licensing authority, we already have discretion to think about how we might ratchet up the sanctions or the conditions or the expectations about how people behave under licence. And that's a civil issue, not a criminal issue.
I understand the difference. But you could bypass Nature. Would you bypass Nature Scot when you think, well, it's right in front of us here, we can go through. So you would go to them, but the prosecution would take priority, I take it, over anything else?
We would do both. All we would do is be notifying Nature Scot of the investigation that we have, whether that met the kind of threshold for charging and reporting someone or not.
Correct.
Because obviously the threshold is different, and the criminal threshold obviously exceeds that civil threshold that Nature Scot will be working under. So for both the examples you gave, we would be engaging with Nature Scot because obviously the threshold's different, and it would obviously be up to Nature Scots to whether they feel there was enough there to impose any licence restrictions.
So it'd be a dual thing, but we would go straight to prosecution and you'd have suspended the licence meantime, I take it. Possibly.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Ashley, and then we're going to move on to the next question.
I'll be very brief. It's to compare general licensing and grouse licensing is to compare apples and oranges. The legal tests, the legal checks and balances that are required in this context are fundamentally different. When Nature Scot is exercising its general licensing functions, what it is saying is you can do something that would otherwise be illegal. It's what we call a derogation from the law. And if your licence is restricted, your general licence is restricted, effectively what it means is that you're not entitled to right touch regulation in that respect anymore, so you would apply for a specific licence. Grouse shoot licence or suspension or revocation is fundamentally different. It involves depriving a person of their property rights, which is a huge amount of value, which underpins jobs, which has a ripple effect on rural communities, both economically and ecologically. And the gravity of those consequences mean that they can't be compared. We need procedural safeguards. We need decisions that amount to penalties to be underpinned by evidence, at least to the civil standard. And to Christine's point, the criminal law and the civil law sanctions will dovetail, so it's a double whammy, and that can be distinguished from the likes of SEPA, for example, which I'm guessing is why you're asking the question.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. On that very point that you've just made, that phrase that you, the gravity of the consequences of this, Ashley, so, Robbie, I'm going to come back to you on this. I'll make an observation. The gravity of the consequences of raptor persecution and any other wildlife crime that is within the bill is such, to my mind, that it would absolutely deter anyone from carrying out the crime in the first place. And that, to me, is an important part. So, Robbie, Ashley's saying that the example of a general licence restriction is not comparable in terms of the ability to limit the licence of a grouse moor manager. Are you confident that there are sufficient safeguards in your system that would allow you to make the informed decision, given the gravity of the consequences, based on your current system or how this is going to work?
I think that's a useful way of framing it, Jim. And to be honest, again, we will not develop a framework for imposing these suspensions, modifications, restrictions unless we're doing it in consultation with stakeholders. We will build a framework which hopefully provides the reassurance that we are proportionate, that we are targeted, that we are evidence-based, and I have no doubt at all the first time we decide to suspend or revoke a licence, we will be challenged, and I suspect it will go through legal scrutiny to make sure that we have got a framework which is robust and defendable, because it's exactly what happened with general licence restrictions as well. And I hear Ashley's point about apples and oranges. Some of the principles in here are very similar for me, that we can ratchet up the conditions associated with any of our licensing based on the severity of the offences or breaches in front of us, and that is all about proportionality, and those are the issues that are either going to follow or not in terms of ECHR, and indeed if we roll out a framework and apply it and it's challenged legally.
I'm going to bring in Dr. Lovejoy.
Well, can I clarify that point very briefly?
Yeah.
The point that Ashley and Dr. Marnie have talked about in terms of vexatious actions by other people, when you talk about ratcheting it up, does Nature Scot have enough experience and understanding so that when you get a report from Police Scotland to say there's been a raptor persecution incident on this particular estate, you only need to look at it from the licensing point of view, do you have enough of a relationship and an understanding of these situations to be able to say, yeah, we believe that that's vexatious, therefore we will not revoke a licence on this basis at this time?
So, I mean, Dr. Lovejoy referenced the BAS study in 2014. We've carried out an awful lot of work as well, understanding the potential issues with existing provisions and interfering with trapping and snaring. These vexatious issues have been occurring for a long time, and we've been working within a framework, which means we can explore that and give it sufficient airtime and allow estates to make their own representation to us before we make any decision. And indeed, we've been encouraging reporting of trap tampering, because that's all intelligence which is useful for us to help make a decision on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, so there's not going to be a revocation of a licence on the basis of a phone call to say that has happened. You're not going to suddenly suspend a licence. There will be a process that will be gone through.
Absolutely not. And again, just to reassure committee, we would never do that. And the purpose of developing a framework which helps people understand the way in which we would licence is crucial to all of this.
OK, thank you.
Dr. Lovejoy.
Thank you. Just one sentence, I think, to boil this down. The problem is the imposition of a sanction which infringes people's property rights and which infringes the most fundamental procedural guarantees of individuals, with all due respect, based on the trust and confidence of Nature Scott, is plainly unlawful. What we need to focus on is the facts on the ground, not the trust and confidence of Nature Scott. I don't mean that in an offensive way. It's just a matter of fact, isn't it?
Okay. Ashley, did you have a short...
Very short. I just want to paint a picture for the committee of a real-life example. So in springtime last year, a gamekeeper in Perthshire found a dead golden eagle and reported it to the police, handed the bird over. A police investigation was instigated, as you would expect, and in the call for evidence and for people to come forward, the police alluded in that message on Facebook and every social media platform that raptor persecution could have been a cause. Now, during those months, it would have been well within Nature Scott's rights, looking at the face of this bill, to suspend the licence. Now, what actually happened in that case, that there was absolutely no criminality whatsoever. Had this scheme been in place, permanent damage would have been done to that estate with no right to redress whatsoever, no proper appeal right, because how do you prove a negative? That's the kind of situation that we're talking about here. That kind of sanction should only be imposed where the regulator is satisfied that there's guilt to the civil standard. So,
Thank you. We're going to move on to a section on code of practice. Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Camille. I'd like to ask views. What is your view on the need for a code of practice for grouse moor management, and what would you like to see included in the code? And does the bill itself provide enough clarity here, or is this about leaving some flexibility in the system for adaptive management? Rob, we'll start with you on that one.
Yeah, thank you, Jim. I think so. Again, just taking away from some of the specifics and hard choices about licensing, there is no doubt there's an opportunity in this bill to continue to drive up standards. And I'm sure that's something we'd all support, and a code of practice will allow us to do that. We can set quite clearly a framework out to help practitioners understand what they must do, because it's a legal requirement, what they should do and what they could do in terms of best practice. We've got quite a lot of experience of these types of codes in other sectors, whether it's deer. We've got a deer code which does exactly the same. We've got the outdoor access code, and we've got the Muirburn code in itself. So all of these codes, I think, under statute can help drive up standards. We've already got some work moving forward to think about that framework, and using colleagues through the Moorland Forum to help populate it. So I think it's a useful addition, again, to drive up standards.
Okay. Ian Thompson.
I'm going to agree with Robbie. I think the code is essential in ensuring that we have grouse moors that are managed in an environmentally sustainable and legal fashion. So it basically needs to be comprehensive in its content, in addressing things like predator control, mountain hare management under licence, muir burn, and obviously cross-referencing the second part of the bill to do that, the use of medication, the creation of hill tracks and things like that. We suggest that the code needs to be developed by Nature Scott, which is clearly happening, and signed off by their scientific advisory committee. It needs to be founded in evidence. It also needs to be robust. A number of codes that currently exist have provisions that are voluntary. We certainly feel they have to have provisions that must be followed to ensure compliance.
I'm going to bring in Beatrice Wishart here, who's going to open up this question of the code a bit broader, then I'll bring in those who've indicated. Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener, and it follows on from what Ian is saying. So how does the requirement for a code of practice for grouse moor management fit into the bigger picture of the climate and ecological crises and wider context of upland management? And is the Scottish Government being joined up in how it's looking at upland management, including relating to the coherence of the requirements being put on land managers?
So I'll bring in Ashley and then Max.
Thanks. The point I'd like to make on the Code of Practice is that, you know, SLE isn't opposed at all to a Code of Practice being developed, but it's really important that it's developed in consultation with the stakeholders who actually practice land management, not those who are opposed to it. I think our other issue with the Code of Practice is the role that it actually plays in the licensing scheme. Now, the one that's been described in the papers underpinning this bill is really, really broad-ranging and covers land management activities that aren't exclusive to Gousmoors. Now, penalties already exist for the type of conduct that Ian's talking about, that they're self-contained regulation. You know, if you breach the law on Muirburn, then you'll suffer penalties set out in the Hill Farming Act. You know, we can't have inconsistency in how the law is applied. That would have discriminatory effects. And I think it speaks to this overall theme that we're hearing. It's about the proportionality of the bill, ensuring there's proportionality of punishment. As the bill is currently drafted, the Code of Practice is a basis for refusing a licence and for taking it away. That, again, is a step that's far away from rapid crime.
Hey, Max.
Thank you very much, Convener. Regarding the text of the Code of Practice, it reads as follows: how land should be managed to reduce disturbance of and harm to any wild animal, wild bird and wild plant, how the taking or killing of any wild bird should be carried out, how predators should be controlled. Revive, the Coalition would also like to ask why these activities are happening in the first place as well. So, we welcome that the legislation on the trapping is going to put trapping under a national framework, and that it's going to legislate for all these kinds of traps nationally, which is very good. But the question of why, if one was to apply for a hypothetical licence for reasons for killing wildlife, whether it's on a grouse moor or otherwise, you know, a legitimate reason might well be protecting livestock. It might well be for ecology or conservation, but should a licence be given for the purpose of increasing grouse numbers for sport shooting? Revive, as a coalition, doesn't think so. We're bringing that question to the table, but certainly it's very, very important that the Code of Practice is actually going to be part of a legal framework from our point of view, so that it can be enforced and linked to the licence legally.
Ashley.
Just a quick point in response to Max, and I say this with respect, this debate isn't about whether or not grouse shooting should continue in Scotland, it's about whether this bill is a proportionate response to the perceived issue of raptor persecution on grouse moors. It's whether this is an effective and proportionate deterrent.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to the topic of annual licences, a question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Reasonably quick question, I hope, and that is about the period of the licence. So the bill sets out that 16AA licences must be for a period not exceeding 1 year. I just want to ask people if they have views if that's the right period of time.
Ashley, kick off.
Yes, thank you. The annual licence framework is very problematic. All that will do is add to the cost of the scheme and to the administrative burden of Nature Scot. We already have a full plate without delivering any evident public benefit. The justification given in the policy memorandum is irrational. It basically says licences will be granted annually because grouse shooting is a seasonal activity. But the significant financial investment that goes into grouse moor management is long-term. The employment of gamekeepers is long-term. The capital and investment is long-term and requires a long-term outlook. And likewise, that the concerns about raptors that underpin this scheme are long-term. You know, that's not a seasonal problem. So it's certainly illogical as far as we see it. We think the licence provisions should be amended to provide that licences are granted indefinitely. Nothing is lost by doing that. You would still, in a long-term licence, be able to remove it or suspend it. You would also be able to impose some form of reporting requirement if that was possible. So, in summary, the annual licence causes problems without delivering any benefit.
Can I just pick on that point? You really mean indefinitely?
Well, why not? Think about premises licensing. What's lost by doing that? trap licensing, for example, 10 years. What's needed here is it clarity and certainty for businesses so that they can continue to invest in moorland management. If that investment is disincentivised, then Scotland's rural economies, rural environment will suffer.
Okay, can I bring in Robbie just to answer that? Why do you think an annual licence is appropriate?
I think, to be honest, Convener, we would probably prefer to see a little bit more flexibility in the bill than the prescription that's there just now. For a variety of reasons, administrative efficiency is just one.
Okay. Can I ask a question? I presume if a licence is granted indefinitely, there will be ability within the bill as it sits just now for the conditions of that licence to change without the applicant having to apply if through secondary legislation there was changes to the licence requirements. Would that be right?
Well, I think all I'm saying is I would prefer to see an opportunity for us to think about a sensible timescale in which a duration of licence would work without necessarily being tied to an annual prescription.
Okay. Jim Fairley.
Yeah. Thank you, convener. Can I? Do you want to ask first?
Jim, could you just ask your question, please? Thank you.
I'm afraid he didn't see what he would suggest, rather than just...
I'll come back to you.
Through the chair, please, yeah. Christine. Jim.
I think this goes back to a bit of the severity of this crime and the potential repercussions for the person who owns the licence. There's somebody who held a licence for Raven Control. We had to have a licence every year, and it got to the point where it was just a case of, yep, put your form in and it's returned. Now, I get that might cause administration issues for yourselves, Robbie, but what it also did was clarified in your mind that it was breaking the law and you had a duty to make sure that your licence was in place before you actually started to control something that was causing you a severe problem. So I get that that might be slightly more onerous on yourself, but would you accept the fact that the annual licensing would actually keep people's minds firmly on the fact?
I don't think that anyone operating a grouse moor at the moment is forgetful of the fact that they may lose their ability to operate a grouse moor as a result of these restrictions. I come back to the point, if you have a licence, it can be taken away if you commit an offence, or you're alleged to have committed an offence, suspected to commit offence as currently drafted, irrespective of whether that licence operates for 10 years, for 20 years or for 1 year. NFU, for example, back us up on this. They say applying and gaining a licence on a yearly basis is an extremely short time frame, and we would strongly suggest making this a period longer. The licensing regime should not be overly complex, onerous or burdensome for the land manager, who will already have multiple competing priorities to contend with. So this is an organisation that doesn't even have a grouse shooting interest, telling you that businesses need certainty. And again, it comes back to these principles of better regulation. It's about the regulator enabling people to carry out their activities in a lawful way, and I'm afraid that that's lost when you get into the context of an annual licensing scheme.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Jamie Whittle and then Dr. Lovejoy.
Thank you, Convener. In many ways, it's echoing some of the points that have been made already, but certainly if the process of renewal isn't a straightforward one, then the Law Society have commented that it could be unduly burdensome, not just on Nature Scott, Police Scotland, but also the states. We had suggested in our responses that it may be more appropriate to look at the timescale of, say, 3 to 5 years, bearing in mind also that under other licensing regimes, such as civic licensing, they often use a 3-year timescale. And just picking up on the point about certainty, just it's really the point that many grouse moor operations will be taking bookings before a year-long period is ended. So they're taking bookings in advance, and it's just that certainty of being able to plan and for their guests coming to Scotland or shooting elsewhere.
Thank you. Dr. Lovejoy.
Thank you. I fully endorse what Ashley said on the point of annual licences. I just want to add that we are not just looking at business investment, but we are also looking at investment in nature conservation. And a lot of these investments undertaken by landowners are long-term and privately funded. And an annual license and the uncertainty of an annual license will risk undermining these long-term conservation projects. By the way, just to offer a comparative view from England, we have an annual license to release game birds in and around protected sites. And this year, the license has been changed at very short notice, which led to significant economic, environmental, and legal impacts. So the uncertainty in relation to an annual license is a real problem.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Max and then Ross.
Just very briefly, it's important to mention that for the public interest as well, that you know, regardless of whether it's a year or a bit more for the licensing to be renewed, full cost recovery will be important, so that there's not a burden to the public purse in this scheme. So I just wanted to raise that point, that regularity of accruing the fees for the licence might be an important thing to consider in this debate as well.
I think we're going to come on to that later. Ross.
And thank you, Convener. A couple of mentions so far about better regulation, and I'm relieved to hear that Nature Scot will be working to that. Within the conditions of better regulation laid down by the regulator's code, there are things like positive enabling approach and pursuing outcomes that contribute to sustainable economic growth, evidence-based protocols to target action where it's needed, and help those that regulate to design simple and cost-effective compliance to improve confidence in day-to-day management. Certainly in our work so far, we'll aim to support that objective of better regulation. Important to underline that, I think.
Thank you. Before we move on, just a question to Robbie. You suggested more flexibility. How would that actually look? Would that be an annual rolling licence? Would it be a five-year licence, a 10-year licence? So can you actually tell us what your thoughts are on that?
Well, I kind of agree with most of the points that have been made around the table. We need to make sure that there's a balance struck here between providing certainty for investment decisions, absolutely, but at the same time as make sure that we've got sufficient flexibility to review what's happening on an annual basis. We would expect annual returns as part of any licence, because again, that's one of the conditions we would expect. We want that intelligence to come back so we can be better informed about what's happening under licence. And I suspect the licence duration of between 3 and 5 years sounds about right and sits much more comfortably with other civil licensing schemes, which we know work quite well.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you. One of the things that Werity seemed to, or did rather, recommend was that Nature Scot would have power to impose fines. I wonder if Nature Scot can clarify whether that is what we're now talking about, and if it isn't, whether it should be.
So very conscious during Professor Verity's considerations that as a range of civil sanctions could come into play to think about how we continue to tackle the inherent problem wrapped to persecution. Civil penalties was absolutely part of that discussion. I don't think our thinking has sufficiently moved on to think about whether or not that as a tool within the toolkit is going to aid or not this particular issue.
So would you have the power to impose fines?
Within this bill?
Within this bill, no.
No.
But you don't feel that's an area that you would want, a power that you would need to have an effective range of sanctions?
Well, again, I think the most likely successful civil sanction that we've talked about so far is the removal of the licence. That's going to have, as a backstop power, Mr Allen, I think that's probably the one that we've put our faith in.
Okay, I'm going to move on to a question now about the cost recovery that I touched on earlier. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. We did touch upon that. It's just in regards to there being a fee for a licence, and does the panel agree with the approach in the bill on fees, and how do you feel about the way that the licensing scheme would be resourced? So I'd like to open that up.
Ashley.
Thank you. Looking at the bill's final BRIA and the financial memorandum, it appears that ministers have failed to make any real assessment of what costs might be borne by owners and occupiers of land if this regime is introduced. I've got a quote from the financial memorandum that simply states, individuals and businesses may apply for a licence if they meet the specified criteria to continue to be able to take grouse, use wildlife traps and make muir burn without cost. Well, that's patently wrong. The cost of regulation extends well beyond the fees charged by the regulator, and it's deeply regrettable that the BRIA fails to identify and analyse those cost impacts. And I think that's a vital point for this committee, because robust BRIAs that are underpinned by reliable data are what help you make laws that don't have unintended consequences. It's what allows you to strike the right balance when it comes to regulation and identify those unintended impacts and mitigate them. Now, I am conscious of constraints on time, but I would like to just draw the committee's attention to some of the main deficiencies with the BREA. And the first one is that the Scottish Government's own toolkit for BREAs, that's its guidance on how they should be conducted, says that it should engage in face-to-face discussions with 6 to 12 businesses on the impact of proposed legislation. Despite that, not a single business or individual who was affected by this bill was interviewed, and that's exactly the kind of failure of process that leads to bad law. The simplistic justification given was that the proposed changes will minimally affect businesses that respect wild animal welfare and the associated legislation. Well, how can you arrive at that conclusion if you haven't interviewed a single business? And the complacency in that approach is hugely disappointing, especially given the emphasis that the Werity Group placed on the need to better understand the socio-economic sphere that we're operating in here. The BREA doesn't help us understand, for example, the role that Grousemoors play in the rural economy, the breadth of jobs and businesses that might be affected, and on the specifics of the scheme proposed, the impact of the one-year licence, as we've just discussed, the ease with which they can suspend it, which could be discussed. These are all cost impacts, so I think it's vital that they're looked at when we're having this discussion. This is a real-world impact, and that's why I'm being expansive on it. We're talking about people's lives, jobs, tied accommodation being put at risk here.
Yeah, sorry, it was just I was just wanted to get the specifics on the licensing fee itself and if that was proportionate for what was being asked, because maybe it's appropriate to bring Max in here because he touched upon that earlier.
If I could just respond, I think there's two issues at play. There's a commitment in the Bute House Agreement to full cost recovery, but that doesn't form part of this bill. What's said in the bill is it's
to licensing, because it's not unreasonable to ask people to pay for a licence that happens across all licences.
A licence fee, I don't think SLE would oppose there being a licence fee per se.
Yeah.
The point is that the cost, the overall cost, has not been assessed as part of this bill. And I should say we are opposed to full cost recovery, but again, a bit premature because it doesn't form part of this bill.
I would agree with what Karen Adams said, that it's not unreasonable to expect a payment for it, and I welcome the SLE agree.
Okay. No further comments on Ian?
All I would add to that is we all know that budgets are constrained and that will apply to Nature Scott as much as it does for anything else. Nature Scott's remit also covers nature protection and recovery, and in our view it's absolutely imperative that resources are targeted at those objectives and not diverted to the administration of a licensing scheme. So we absolutely agree that this should be cost neutral, at least to the public purse.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask, Robbie, what are you reviewing and what are your options with regards to cost recovery?
So we currently don't charge for any of our licensing functions, and let's be aware that we issue 5,000 species licences per annum. Some of those are quite clearly delivering public interest, and therefore it's maybe not appropriate to charge. But increasingly, as Ian said, we are having to look afresh at where there are opportunities to ensure that our licensing burden is actually not meaning that we're putting all of our resources into administering things where arguably there's a strong rationale for full cost recovery and charging.
Okay, thank you. We're going to now move on to our final topic.
The code of practice, just briefly, what you didn't notice that I'd indicated. I just wondered if any of the stakeholders had any comment on whether if a code of practice was any part of it was not followed. I mean, RSPB might have a comment on this as to whether a licence could be revoked or suspended.
Ian?
In our view, the Code of Practice has to have statutory provisions, and if an assessment on a licence application is based on one of the criteria being on whether an applicant is adhering to a Code of Practice, then yes, potentially if they aren't, they could lose their licence or be refused a licence in the first place. I think that's entirely reasonable.
And is that the position that Nature Scott hold?
The reality is, again, it depends on circumstances, but compliance with the Code of Practice, if there's any breach of that code, would be part of our considerations about whether or not a revocation, suspension, modification is necessary. So we would want to take into account the code when considering it, but it depends on the nature of the breach.
But is the code of practice, it's going to be developed with stakeholders, but how do they know what that code of practice looks like?
Well, it doesn't exist yet, so the
but how can we scrutinise it if we don't know what it looks like?
Well, I don't think the code will benefit from parliamentary scrutiny.
But if a licence is to be revoked or suspended, then surely it is up to our committee to scrutinise what it looks like. OK, that's just a point.
Hey, Dr. Lovejoy.
I do actually agree with Rachel. We don't know what the code of practice looks like. How can anybody in this room make an informed decision of whether this bill is proportionate or not? We need to know the full extent of it. And it goes back to the clarity of law. We need to have some certainty here, and at the moment this bill is lacking it.
Okay, thanks. Alistair Allen, very briefly.
Just to be fair, on that point, you know, this is true of literally every piece of legislation which has either subsidiary legislation or regulation or dependent licensing based on it. And we've been through many bills in this Parliament. We've had this discussion, but, you know, there is an issue of carts and horses here that we can scrutinise licences, but we can't scrutinise them until we've got legislation to empower organisations to have licences.
Briefly.
I think the problem is that the sanctions can be so far-reaching that it is a very important point in this case. I do appreciate what you're saying, but I think the intrusiveness of the bill requires more clarity.
Okay, before we move on to the final topic, Jim Fielder's got some questions to tidy up the ECHR question.
Yep.
and this is specifically aimed to yourself, James. Jamie, sorry, my apologies. Do you have any? We've heard views from various stakeholders that they believe that this may not be compliant with the European Convention on Human Rights. Do you have any? Do you have a view on the concerns raised by the stakeholders that the provisions of the bill and the licensing may not be compliant, and, for example, due to potential disproportionate interference with property rights? What is your view on that?
As I mentioned earlier, and thank you for that question, the Law Society of Scotland have a subcommittee on human rights, and they haven't specifically considered the bill from this angle. So I can go back and seek a written response to the Parliament on that in particular. What I maybe say just about property rights is that in across Scotland, property rights lie on various different levels, and you see whether it's ownership or leases or rights of access that are affected by legislation in different ways. So I just see it all coming together, it all fitting in a matrix of different laws and different levels. So I think by default, whenever there is any legislation created, it has the potential impact of limiting people's rights. That's just part and parcel of the way in which the law works.
But you would write to the committee to give us the view after we're finished today?
Yes, well, I'll feed back to Law Society of Scotland and ask for a written response on that particular point.
Thank you very much. So property rights under Article 1 of the First Protocol 1 of the European Convention of Human Rights are indeed not absolute rights, as Jamie mentioned, and they can be infringed by state interference. However, the infringement of state interference has to follow three conditions. So first of all, it has to be implemented in law, which would be the case here because we'd have a statutory instrument. It would need to be in the public interest, which is debatable here. So there are two very different opinions. And fundamentally, it needs to be proportionate. And in order to assess the proportionality of an infringement in property rights, procedural safeguards are one fundamental element. So if we look at just the provision which we discussed earlier already, that a license can be potentially suspended for an unlimited amount of time based on no wrongdoing whatsoever, simply based on a phone call to the police which triggers an official investigation, I've no doubt in my mind that this would be considered disproportionate. And I've no doubt in my mind that this will lead to court cases.
Okay, thank you. Right, Christine?
We haven't touched on appellate procedure, and that would deal with ECHR. If somebody has a licence suspended, if you just briefly say how quickly, depending on circumstances, an appeal might go against either revocation of licence, suspension of licence, or indeed varying the terms of the licence.
Yeah, so
I think that's very important, somebody's rights, when a judgment has been made that they have a right to appeal on cause shown.
On any potential suspension, on receipt of information received, could be from a variety of sources, our first port of call would be to contact the licence holder to understand what might be going on. And before we took any decision to suspend, I think procedurally, on your point, fairness, there's a right to respond to any suggestion that we may revoke a licence. That is us safeguarding ourselves as a public body, that we are being proportionate in discharging our regulatory functions. That's built into the framework we've already got for general licence and would need to be built into any future framework.
It's not in the law, though.
It's not in the law.
Thank you, Christine. It's a really important point, and I really welcome Robbie's commitment to that, but the internal appeals process, the internal notification that he talks about and the right to be heard is not enshrined in primary legislation. The bill needs to be amended to reflect that. And there's a second very short point on appeals, I promise. The bill doesn't allow the sheriff the discretion to provide on an interim basis that the suspension or revocation imposed by Nature Scott is of no effect pending determination of the appeals. Now, as a litigator, appeals take a very long time. You could be waiting well over a year to get your determination. During that time, if that business isn't able to operate, the damage would be permanent. There's no reparation.
Thank you. Ian Thompson.
We have a concern that the appeals process is quite one-sided. Proceedings appear to be limited to consideration of decisions to suspend or revoke a licence, and it's our feeling that in the interests of justice and even-handedness and compliance with the Aarhus Convention, a person should be able to appeal the granting of a licence or the failure to attach a condition or the failure to modify, suspend or to revoke a licence.
Okay, very briefly.
Very briefly. It would be extremely unusual to see that third right of appeal in the context of a statutory appeal structure in this context. It would be open to parties aggrieved to judicially review decisions, which is the much more appropriate forum for that kind of dispute.
Robbie, did you indicate?
Rehearsing some of our existing controls in place when we do restrict general licences and there is an appeals process internally with the Nature Scott, the suspension is effectively on hold. There is no suspension whilst an appeal is undertaken. So that safeguard exists within our processes already. And again, to provide some reassurance, we fully expect that would be the case in any future licensing scheme.
Okay.
It'll
have to be very brief.
Yeah, well, it's very significant on the financial implications. If, because you have these powers and there could be financial implications, does it mean that Article 6 of the ECHR, could that be then violated because you've... Well, I'm trying to... I don't know whether it's the Law Society that should answer this, but do you take the financial implications into consideration and do you have due regard to the violation of Article 6?
That's maybe not a question for me on the specifics of ECHR, but our founding legislation, the Natural Heritage Act, requires us to be... to apply our balancing duties and considering...
But how do you do that?
Well, it's really in behaviours and frameworks like I've talked about today in terms of this is what we consider to be a proportionate way of responding to all of those issues.
And do you believe that the framework is proportionate?
The ones we operate today, absolutely.
Today?
To date.
To date in this bill?
And within our existing licensing functions, and we fully expect to consider to apply those similar principles in any future legislation and licensing regime.
OK, we're going to move on to our final topic. Unfortunately, we've got very little time for this. Again, so we'll keep the questions and answers succinct. It's on SSPCA powers and Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. The committee would be interested to hear what are the key considerations regarding whether or not
Scottish SPCA should have additional powers to investigate wildlife crime. And we'd be interested to hear from people who haven't come representing from the previous panel, because we had that question last week. So maybe I'll start with Jamie Whittle. Did you catch my question?
Thank you. In the response that the Law Society provided, we suggested that criminal investigations should be kept refined to the police and the Crime Prosecution Service rather than extending to the SSPCA. One of the thoughts behind that was, with the SSPCA being a registered charity, whether it was appropriate for that scope of investigation to fall on its behest.
And then maybe I can hear from RSPB and Revive. They weren't here last time.
We support an extension of SSPCA powers. SSPCA already have powers to investigate some wildlife crime on the basis that an animal is suffering. To give a very brief example, a few years ago, a member of the public was walking across a grouse moor and found a gull floundering in an illegally set springtrap, bleeding heavily. Because there was an immediate welfare implication, the Scottish SPCA were called, an inspector attended within an hour and euthanised the gull. What his powers did not allow him to do was to search for similar traps. And it was only a week later, when the police went onto the ground using their powers under Section 19 of the 1981 Act, that it was found there had been a line of 10 traps set across that hillside. Had the SSPCA been given powers to search land under the Wildlife and Countryside Act, then there was the potential that that evidence could have been uncovered much quicker and potentially spared other animals from suffering.
So there were animals in those other traps?
No, there weren't. They weren't found. That's the thing. What was found was where they had been set.
Yeah. I mean, I would certainly, just to say briefly, I would agree with Ian with that, and any measures that can take place to increase the capacity for increased animal welfare across our lands is to be welcomed.
Ashley.
As Ariane alluded to, SLE did have an opportunity to ventilate its concerns on this last week, but I would echo the sentiment of the Law Society, and I would also endorse the response that Police Scotland have provided on this, which is that it is simply not appropriate for a charity that has at its core an animal welfare concern to be investigating wildlife crime. It creates a huge amount of scope for bias and conflict of interest.
David.
Yes, well, obviously this is a discussion that's been going on for a number of years, and Police Scotland have maintained a consistent approach to this issue. So we have several concerns, really. We believe we should remain, you know, the lead enforcement agency, obviously, in terms of wildlife crime. We're concerned about confusion amongst members of the public about who to report incidents to. If they were to report incidents directly to the SSPCA and they were to commence investigations to a greater extent than they can now, we have concerns that the investigation could progress. And when police do become involved, we may be at a disadvantaged position because things we would have done maybe earlier would not have been done. Impartiality is an issue. Obviously, it's been discussed already in terms of an animal welfare charity having increased powers. For example, publicly opposing snaring, which is a legal practice if done properly, appropriately. Capacity in terms of training, resourcing and things to kind of accommodate additional powers. And also, albeit I've got some anecdotal evidence of an incident fairly recently, within the last sort of couple of years, where police and SSPCA were working in an operation together, and a member of the public was very, very resistant to basically being kind of ultimately told what to do and being controlled by the powers under the SSPCA, and said he was more than happy to speak and engage with the police, but was very reluctant to do so by what ultimately is an animal welfare charity, by a charitable organisation. And that there were issues there, and the officer that I spoke to about that has made reference to that it was clear that there could be that resistance from the public as well.
Okay. Can I maybe ask Ian, how do you respond to those stakeholders like David who have concerns about the SSPCA carrying out further official duties given their charitable and funding model?
The SSPCA are a reporting agency, so they are already able to report directly to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. They are the lead body in animal welfare cases.
But this is about criminality. This is about investigation of crimes. So it's not about animal welfare issues.
No, but they investigate crimes. They have a special investigations unit, for example, that investigates crimes related to puppy farming. By and large, they, in our experience with them, is they work very much in partnership with the police. So they complement each other.
Jim Fairley.
Yeah, very quickly, David, this is specifically to yourself. You do currently work with the SSPCA. How does it currently work? And you probably answered it already. You'll have concerns about extending the powers of the SSPCA if this provision was to go ahead.
Yes, so we do work well with the SSPCA. We're in regular contact with them. We work together regularly. We work well together, and we appreciate the hard work that they do and the contribution they make. Generally speaking, their powers at the moment are primarily in relation to non-wild animals. And obviously, I believe it's Section 19 powers that they're looking to kind of take on, which they're very, very broad powers. In police terms, Section 19 powers are excellent. They're very, very strong powers we have. As I've said, I've outlined the kind of concerns that we have, obviously, in relation to extending those powers to the SSPCA. Okay.
Thank you.
I think that was the last question you've just asked, unless there's any other comments on SSPCA. It's on SSPCA, yes.
Yes, it is, but it's, I don't know if it's to Ian or David, but just in some of the Police Scotland's written evidence, it actually states that... the stuff that you do with some of the inquiries around organised crime, that if the SPCA were given more powers, that it could hinder some of that. I just want to get some clarification around that as to why there's a difference in opinion here, because obviously this is about ensuring that investigations are more successful, I suppose, and so we need to make sure that that criminal investigation is robust. So why do you think that the RSPB have got a different opinion to you in that term?
So I think when it comes to increasing power, obviously, I think the key thing to think about is could it potentially hinder police involvement? So the SSPCA could commence an investigation, for example, hypothetical situation, they could commence an investigation, start working towards their ultimate objective, and we could become involved down the line, but at which point some investigative opportunities may not be there anymore because SSPCA don't have the same access to systems that we have, potentially financial inquiries, which is a big part of wildlife crime now. I think wildlife crime, I believe I read in a report recently, it's the fourth highest generator of illicit funds internationally. So financial aspects are a big part of wildlife crime now as well. Now, I think the SSPCA have ability to do phone downloads, but from memory I don't believe their power extends far beyond that in terms of things like accessing public space, CCTV, if it were to be relevant in an unlikely event with wildlife crime, but there's possibility that things like that could come into play. So it's just general access to kind of systems. I know they have their own sort of intelligence database, but obviously we've got the Scottish Intelligence Database, which is a network of intelligence. It shows links to nominals, to areas, to vehicles and things. So we could potentially put a picture together fairly quickly based on our intelligence that we hold about links to serious and organised crime, links to other individuals. So very quickly, a small investigation could branch out into a much wider investigation. So there's just a bit of concern about the lack of kind of access to the systems and the resources that we have, which could ultimately hinder any investigation if we come into play at a later time.
Okay,
Ian.
I don't know what extent of powers that are being discussed. I mean, that's one of the reasons, one of the concerns in this, in that it's actually quite a vague concept what extra powers the SSPCA will get. And I absolutely agree that Section 19 is huge. As far as I'm aware, it's limited provisions to access land they're looking for, not powers to sort of stop vehicles, search vehicles, etc., etc. From our perspective, and in dealing with cases on the ground, what the SSPCA can do is provide that very early initial capacity when you have an animal dangling by its broken legs in a trap. in rural areas in particular, it is often very difficult to get a police officer to attend. Now, that's not a criticism of Police Scotland, it's about resource. Scottish SPCA have 60-odd uniformed inspectors whose sole function is dealing with animal welfare issues, and invariably they are able to respond quicker in many circumstances to Police Scotland officers. I would hope that whatever happens down the line, there is very good partnership working as there is now, and I don't see any extra powers of the SSPC would get compromising that.
The trap was that, and when was it? Because on again at our Grousmore visit on Monday, we were told that if a trap had been tampered with, then an incident like you described with the gull could happen. But also some of the older types of traps, such as the fen traps, that couldn't happen anymore, and all gamekeepers are licensed to work the traps, and they showed us how they worked, and that's certainly a non-target species would not be able to enter that trap.
The bottom line is these were traps that had been set illegally. It was a line of fen traps that had been set, baited next to rabbits across a hillside.
And are fen traps still used?
Fen traps are still used. They're permitted for catching weasels. But these traps were not set legally. I mean, fen traps, prior to the change in the law a couple of years ago, they still had to be set undercover to target mustelids and rats. These ones were set in the open next to a bait and covered in a thin layer of moss so they weren't visible. And what happened is the gull obviously went down to feed from the dead rabbit and got its legs smashed in the trap.
So, okay, just for official report, when was that?
Forgive me, I think it was 2016.
Okay.
Okay. Christine, a very, very brief supplementary, because we're half an hour over time.
I declare an interest as a member of the SSPCA, and I absolutely appreciate the commonality and the goodwill between both the police and the SSPCA. Why would the SSPCA be seeking more powers? In what circumstance would they be seeking it?
Presumably, as Ian Thompson has referenced, occasions like that where an animal's perhaps trapped or in need of assistance, presumably for occasions like that.
Would you accept that if there were those limitations, you don't want to compromise the evidence that might be available for a prosecution, would you accept that that might be the very circumstance where the powers, it would be useful to extend them? Because they can just, and probably government will not forgive me for this, but there aren't enough wildlife crime police officers. That's just a fact. And that they're able to just do that early bit to secure it, to see it, and then you could take over in certain circumstances.
I mean, in theory, very limited powers. We wouldn't be against very limited powers in an occasion like that. However, okay. I don't know if there's really an ability to do that, though. Once you're giving them the power to enter on to the land under Section 19, it opens up a broad range of possibilities from then on.
We can find out, and yes, it's always available at stage two. We've got to get it more specific.
If it was for the purposes of purely entering onto land to protect an injured animal, retrieve an injured animal, and co-working with the police, then it's something that we could discuss, certainly. Yep.
Thank you. That brings the session to end. Thank you all very much for your patience and the additional time that you provided. We're going to suspend the meeting until 11:15, but if I could ask witnesses to leave the room as quickly as possible to allow the changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much.
We've now reconvened the meeting, and I welcome our second round table. On this round table on Muirburn, we have Ross Ewing, the Director of Moorland from Scottish Land and Estates. We've got the Deputy Assistant Chief Officer, Bruce Farquharson, from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Dr Miranda Gailhood, the Policy Coordinator from Scottish Crofting Federation. Nick Hesford from the Scottish Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust. Dr Emma Hinchcliffe, Director from IUCN UK Peatland Programme. And Robbie Kernahan, once again, he's a glutton for punishment, the Director of the Green Economy from Nature Scott. And finally, Duncan Orr Ewing, the Head of Species and Land Management from the RSPB. Again, if I can ask that anybody who would like to contribute, if they raise a hand, and if all the questions and responses could be directed through the chair. We have, in 90 minutes, we're very tight on this because unfortunately we've got there's a further committee after this. So I'd appreciate again if the questions and responses could be as brief as possible. So once again, I'm going to kick off with a very broad question. So I'm going to ask, what is your understanding of the pattern of Muirburn across Scotland? We were fortunate enough to be invited to a Grousemuir yesterday and on Monday and got an idea. But could you tell us what, on an annual basis, typically what would be burnt, how long the rotations typically are, and how do burning practices differ for Grousemuir management compared to farms or on crofts? I'll start with Ross Ewing and then Nick Hesford.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Thank you very much for having us here today. I think probably just important to maybe give you a flavour of, I suppose, what the national overview of the Muirburn footprint looks like. And kind of the best source of this, I would argue, comes actually from the Scottish Government Stage 2 research into the socioeconomic and biodiversity impacts of driven grouse moors, and in particular, the paper by Keith Matthews and others in 2020. They mapped grouse butts onto rough grazing in Scotland, which covered 491 landholdings in all, and that spanned a total of 1 million hectares. And of those 1 million hectares, about 858,000 hectares were classified as rough grazing, of which 163,000 hectares, that's 19%, was subjected to Muirburn. And then if you look a little bit more granular, if you go within 2 kilometres of the grouse butts, the total area of rough grazing falling within those 2 kilometres was 584,000 hectares. And of that, some 146,000 hectares, that's 25%, was subject to Muirburn. So if you're looking at kind of the extent of it across Scotland, it probably applies to, certainly in relation to driven grouse moor management, to about 163,000 hectares. But in terms of the rotations that you mentioned, Convener, you're talking usually between 10 and 25 years, although between 10 and 15 years is probably more commonplace for grouse moor management. And the size of the Muirburn strips can vary, and obviously we don't have a practitioner who actually does Muirburn maybe on the ground here today that can give us this insight, but we've consulted widely, and generally fires are kept to between about 10 to 15 metres wide, and they generally get smaller over the years because the fuel load is being managed over that time. And what I would argue here as well is that there are much crossover with agricultural interests, because clearly these land uses are integrated. You've got sheep farming operations quite often coexisting with grouse moor management operations, and as a result, some of the Muirburn for Moorland Game and Wildlife tends to benefit livestock and vice versa.
Thank you. Nick.
Thanks, Convener. I echo a lot of what Ross has just said there. I think it's important for us to understand that Muirburn, in terms of its size and rotation period, varies significantly depending on the spatial, temporal, or even environmental context. So, for example, where you have drier areas, they might be burnt more frequently than, say, wetter areas where vegetation regrowth would be slower. But typically, as Ross has sort of mentioned, a rotation may be anywhere between 10 to 25 years, depending, and even beyond that, depending on the vegetation itself. When managing for a red grouse, the aim is to produce a habitat mosaic of small interconnected burns. So you have a real diversity of heather ages. And the GWT team would not advise fires any larger than a 30 metre width, but typically these fires are much smaller than that. We do hold data at GWT for about 25 upland estates across Scotland where driven grouse shooting is the primary management objective, on how many fires, the size of those fires, peak depth at the ignition point of those fires, but that is not data that I have analysed or could share with you today, but we could potentially look at those data going forward.
Thank you, Duncan.
Yeah,
Yeah, so just to say, Convener, we're contacted every year about breaches to the Muirburn Code, and that could be damage to bird nests, it could be... I'm coming to the stats here.
So we're just looking at the pattern of Muirburn rather than, because we've got about 20 questions which will look into the, reasons, whatever.
Just on the pattern of Muirburn, we have conducted a citizen science project in recent years, a Muirburn app where people can report Muirburn incidents, and just for the purposes of this discussion, 17% of the burns were on peatland deeper than 50 centimetres in the 2022-23 burning season. That's 28 out of 162 incidents. And I think the other very important point for this discussion is that actually there is science conducted by one of our people, David Douglas, which shows that particularly on grouse moors, Muirburn intensity has been increasing in the past 20 years, which is one of the reasons why we're having this conversation.
Thank you. Yeah, it's really difficult to say there's a sort of the extent of burning on peatland. Obviously, Duncan has just provided some stats, but there's a lacking a common definition of peatland, which provides some challenges. So, Muirburn.
Sorry, can I stop you there again? Because we will be coming on to that. It's just specifically about what the picture is at the moment regards the pattern of Muirburn across Scotland.
Okay.
Miranda.
Yes, what I would add to that is that one of the sort of the key concerns for us is also about the definition of Muirburn. So I think a lot of the statistics that we're hearing is what we generally perceive Muirburn, quite large scale, heather burning. But it's our understanding that that actually the bill would apply to any use of fire for the control of vegetation, which could be much broader, which might not be adequately captured by the statistics that we're seeing, because it could be really small scale, could consider just burning of gorse, for example, but actually that the requirements would still apply in that context. So the breadth of the requirements could be much wider than actually what the statistics are suggesting.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Just on that point about the pattern of Muirburn and how it differs across different sectors, obviously one of the things that's different about crofting is that sometimes this is being taken, sometimes this is happening rather than on common grazings and involves multiple crofters, and it's a different kind of activity. I don't know if you want to comment on that, Miranda?
No, I can agree with that, but I have nothing else to add.
It's a very, very quick point. Duncan or Ewing just mentioned there about the intensity of Muirburn increasing. I've got to say that is contested. And indeed, the paper by Matthews and others as part of the Stage 2 research said that there were incidents where it was both increasing and decreasing. So just to put that on the record.
Okay. Jim Fairley.
Robbie Kiernan was going to come in on the pattern for crofters, I think.
Well, again, there is limited, precise information about the extent of Muirburn, both current and historical, but Nature Scotland has developed a kind of semi-automated protocol to map the extent of burning using Sentinel 2 satellites. So just for context, the last 3 years there's been about 10,000 hectares of burning. What we haven't been able to do is break that down into specific Muirburn prescription versus fires that have gotten out of control. So our ability to monitor burning is improving all the time as technology improves. So one of the benefits of a licensing scheme is to give us that type of data and we can have a bit more confidence in it.
Okay, thank you. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, you've just answered part of the question I was going to ask in terms of what the monitoring was, how you would monitor it, and will the Muirburn provisions help achieve a more complete understanding of how the burn is used in Scotland and its effects? And I have to say, hindsight's a wonderful thing, but it would have been great to have some of the people who were actually handling the fires that were going up north last week. So real pity we don't have some of them here today to talk about what it actually means. One of the benefits of the licence is the fact that you'll get better data as the time goes on.
Our expectation through the licensing scheme is we will know what's being burnt, where, for what purpose, and being reassured that the appropriate standards are in place.
Okay. Do you may have got to Bruce first?
Yeah, well, I think Bruce would like to come back in as a practitioner.
So, just to be clear, I'm a Muirburn practitioner, however, I have got experience with fires. And it's just a point of clarity that the fires that happened last week have got nothing to do with Muirburn. Muirburn season is completely finished and we're now into a completely different season. So fires that are started from mid-April onwards, really to conflate them with Muirburn is inaccurate.
Yeah, but in terms of the ability to actually control them if they get out of hand, I was just talking from the point of view of how we actually manage that and whether the licensing scheme help that.
Absolutely. The skills that are brought to bear by those that are practitioners in Muirburn and the equipment they hold and the experience and knowledge they hold is invaluable for the fire service.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Just a small supplementary to Robbie's answer about tracking Muirburn. You said you couldn't tell whether it was actual Muirburn fires or wildfires. Are you able to track that with maybe reference to the fire service? Because they would be aware of what's a wildfire and what is that. They wouldn't have involvement in a managed Muirburn.
Yeah, we can certainly drill down to get a better detail on the specifics of what has prompted those fire incidents, whether it was Muirburn, whether it's something intentional or indeed arson. So we can drill down to provide a better understanding of what's happened within those 10,000 hectares on an annual basis. But again, the benefits of the licensing scheme suggest that we shouldn't need to do that because the data will be coming into us to give us that intelligence, which we currently don't have.
Okay, so you're not able to provide that at the moment?
Not without going to do some further work.
Okay.
Nick.
Thank you. As I alluded to just previously, GWCT in Scotland are already working with landowners and land managers on ways in which they can collect data on their Muirburn. So between 20 and 30 estates, big upland grouse moors, they are currently collecting data on the date that they're burning, the peak depth at the ignition point, some vegetation measures, not that those aren't always collected, but they often are, and also the size of a burn. So these data are currently being collected and held centrally with GWCT, although those data are owned by the estates, which is why I've not been able to share that information today.
Okay, thank you. Rachel, did you have a supplementary?
No, I don't think
that was asked. No,
Rhoda. Thank you. Can I ask, with the new licensing regime proposed in the bill, whether that will strengthen the role of the Muirburn Code, and will that mean that best practice is more prevalent? Maybe.
Robbie, and then Bruce.
So we have a Muirburn Code already. It has no statutory basis, and this bill will allow us to effectively put in place a Muirburn Code which provides that statute, which we would certainly hold practitioners to account for under any licences which we would issue. So, again, hugely supportive of the need to underpin existing practice with greater strength, which is what this bill allows us to do.
Oh, well, we're going to bring Bruce in, and Nick, and then Duncan.
I would echo Robbie's comments that the underpinning of the existing code by a licensing scheme would be hugely beneficial. There is perhaps some scope for the code to have some amendments made to it to reflect practice. As Miranda said earlier on, we've got a broad range of activities that are captured under Muirburn that are very different from each other, but the licensing scheme would absolutely be a benefit.
Again, GWCT would agree on that position. We think that the Muirburn Code should be reviewed and updated to reflect emerging research, though. Without that type of framework, regulation proposed in the bill is unlikely to prove effective.
Okay, Duncan.
Yeah, the problem with the current Muirburn Code is it's largely treated as voluntary. And, you know, we could provide lots of examples, even in this report, that we produced about breaches to the Muirburn Code. Burning out of bird nests was mentioned earlier. An incident was mentioned in the previous evidence of Muirburn close to a golden eagle nest this year, for example. Burning out of tree regeneration, burning on steep slopes and scree. Actually, in the current Muirburn Code, burning on peatland is not allowed, but we know that a lot of burning still happens on peatland soils.
Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Just to say, The vast majority of grouse moor managers specifically do already adhere to the Muirburn Code, and indeed there's been a really concerted effort just in the last year to undertake the voluntary training, the Lantra approved training that's been developed by Bright Spark Burning Techniques, Nature Scott and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. So just to put that on the record. And also I was struck last week by Professor Newton's sentiments, who said, and I quote, "The management of fires in general, at least on grouse moors, I think has improved enormously, at least in my lifetime." And I'd certainly endorse that and caveat, well, su- support it, I suppose, by saying also the development of kind of new equipment, you know, from fogging units through to leaf blowers. Equipment like this basically enables, you know, Muirburn to be conducted really professionally. And just a final point, Convener, just to say that, just back to your kind of key question, Rhoda, your analysis of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee call for views noted that there was 46.5%, that's a majority of people, against the proposed licensing system for Muirburn, and two of the most commonly cited words were unreasonable and disproportionate. So just to kind of give you a flavour maybe of the wider views associated beyond this room.
Miranda.
Yes, we support more effective implementation of the code and looking at options of how to achieve that, for example, mandatory training. However, we have questioned whether licensing is the right way to go. That does come down to questions of accessibility, how well is it suited for small-scale landholders, and also we have cited in a written response to this that there is research conducted in other countries where they have introduced licensing requirements, where it's actually shown that that hasn't resulted in better compliance for reasons, for example, being that people do not obtain the license, and then actually when things go out of control are too afraid to raise the alarm because they have breached that. So I think those will have to be taken into consideration when looking whether this is the right route for a more effective implementation of the Muirburn Code.
Okay, I've got Jim Fairley and then Rhoda Grant.
Yeah, very quick kind of observation. We're talking very much in the round of grouse moor management in terms of Muirburn, but it's not just grouse moor managers that manage Muirburn. Quite often farmers do. My sheep farming friends might not thank me very much for raising this. What is the prevalence of fires that get out of control that are on grouse moors as opposed to sheep farms?
Bruce.
The statistical analysis that we've carried out shows that Muirburn is not a significant factor when it comes to wildfires, and the percentage is around about 5% of Muirburns carried out in driven grouse moors result in a wildfire. When we take in the broader term of Muirburn that includes what farmers and crofters and others do, then the figure does increase, but it's still not a significant factor in the instance of wildfire.
So is wildfire generally accidental cigarettes, stuff like that?
It's always human behaviour in this country. We don't have natural phenomenon that cause wildfires in Scotland yet, and I add the word yet with the caveat of climate change. Yeah. But human behaviour is the predominant reason, it's usually accidental.
Okay. Is it okay to go to Robbie with that one in terms of the licensing for... Because if the licence is going to be for grouse moor management, how does that pick up farmers, crofters, people who don't necessarily have grouse moors on their property, but they still want to burn heather in order to improve habitat for grazing and what have you?
So, I mean, it's a good point, Jim, and I think there is something, again, just to drive home the point, that Muirburn doesn't just happen on grouse moors. Muirburn is a fairly widespread practice, and quite a lot of those burns are up in the northwest, where no grouse moors exist for the purpose of agriculture and actually for game management and thinking about deer, to provide a first early bite for livestock and for game. So I do actually think we need to make sure when we're considering this bill that we think about Muirburn in the round. It's not just about grouse moor management, it's about how burning is managed and the standards associated with that in the crofting world, in the agricultural world, and how we continue to reduce the risk of inappropriate burn and the very real risk of those fires getting out of hand.
Thank you.
We will be moving on to wildfires in a little bit more detail. But Bruce, a question to you. The Muirburn Code, should it include obligations for landowners where there is a risk of wildfire, increased risk of wildfire, to control the fuel load and so on? So in the likes of Portugal, they have strict laws on landowners to ensure that some type of Muirburn, it's probably not called Muirburn in Portugal, but is carried out to reduce the risk of an incident like we had in Inverness last week.
So the Scottish Welfare Forum, which I also chair, issues welfare danger assessments when the threat of wildfire breaches very high or extreme. And the recommendation that comes along with that, and it is just a recommendation, is that those that are carrying out Muirburn take cognizance of those alerts and either don't burn or burn in a very much more small and managed way than perhaps they had been planning. The practice of Muirburn, however, is is instrumental in reducing the risk of wildfire because it manages the fuel load, and it's the fuel load that's the real problem when it comes to the intensity of fire that we're seeing. So climate change isn't having an impact on the number of fires we're having, but it is having an impact on the fire behaviour we're seeing and the intensity of fires. That, combined with an increased fuel load or an unmanaged fuel load, will result in a perfect storm for wildfires.
So in that case, should the new Muirburn Code also cover those who are not burning for biodiversity or grouse moor or agriculture purposes, but basically to reduce fuel load?
Yes, it should, is a short answer. The Muirburn Code should have differentiations, though, between different types of burning. So we have, as we've mentioned, Muirburn for driven grouse, we've got Muirburn for farmers, we've got Muirburn for crofters, and all are different, but they're all being captured under one set of obligations, and they're all very different. So if we were to subdivide Muirburn into those categories, I think the Muirburn Code would be a hugely powerful tool, but it should be within the code that the risk of wildfire has to be a consideration before a flame is applied to vegetation.
OK, thank you. We're now going to move on to the topic of burning on peatland and not peatland, and a question from Rachel Hamilton.
I just wanted the panel to give me their views, give us their views on the distinction that is made between land that is peatland and not peatland for the purpose of Muirburn licensing. OK, I'll start with Nick.
Nick.
Thank you. There is no consensus within the scientific literature that supports the definitions that are laid out in the bill currently. There is no consensus that burning is damaging to peatlands, and if anything, the most robust science, and I'm happy to take questions of what I mean by robust, but the most robust science suggests that actually there are positive impacts of burning on peatlands for a range of ecosystem services, and this is supported by the Nature Scott report 1302, which noted that there is a lack of evidence to determine the impacts of Muirburn on different peat depths. And as such, I would say there is no evidence then to support the recalibration of peatland to 40 centimetres as outlined in the bill. And further to that, peat depths vary considerably within just a few metres across Scottish hillsides. And there is currently no spatial data at any reasonable resolution for peatlands at 40 centimetres. And this makes it absolutely impossible for practitioners to be sure that they would be in compliance with, if a peat depth survey were to be carried out in advance, the resolution of peat depth surveys being a part of the issue there. And our concern is that these definitions may either disincentivise Muirburn because of the confusion, or lead to licences being revoked if found to be carrying out actions against the code or the bill. Therefore, if peatlands, and I think it's important on the definition of peatlands, that we really need to be able to ensure this adaptive management approach that, should be taken in that respect, given the uncertainty around what we define peatland and not. And so that we can continue to sort of contribute to that evidence in a real way. And I should say that peatland definition, on as it currently is, should really be moved towards a focus on ecosystem functioning as opposed to arbitrary depths of peat.
Okay, I've got Duncan and then Emma.
Yeah. So I mean, many bodies have looked at this issue now, including the Climate Change Commission. And they have recommended that who have advised on Scottish Government on land use and tackling meeting net zero targets. And there's a general consensus across these bodies. I mean, we support it, but there are other bodies that think this as well, that there should be no burning on peatland soils. We recognise that the bill, as it stands, provides provision on peatland soils for control of wildfire, and I think you know, broadly, we can accept that, I think, but it needs to be in extremis rather than normal, and we would say that provision needs to be made within the bill to stop this from becoming routine, because essentially the intention of the bill will therefore be bypassed. But I think, you know, if you were going to... I mean, the original Scottish Government response to the Werribee report indicated that there would be a statutory ban on burning on peatlands, and we certainly support that. It would be the easiest to enforce as well, rather than going for sort of peatland depths, as seems to have been the... I mean, so now we seem to be moving in the direction of moving away from that statutory ban on burning on peat. For us, a peatland depth of 40 centimetres is unsubstantiated, but we believe if we are going to use a peatland depth, then 30 centimetres could be substantiated, because that's what's used now by the peatland code. It's also referenced in the UK peatland strategy, and it's supported by the international sort of approach. For example, Richard Lindsay's wetland book also supports a 30 centimetre peat depth definition.
Just a supplementary on that, I understand that CCC are actually reviewing their position on peatland, so that's not at the moment that's not a definite yes or a no from CCC. But given that Muirburn, which is carried out under the Muirburn Code, only burns the vegetation, it doesn't actually burn the peat, so why are you suggesting that 30 centimetres or 40 centimetres is actually important when it doesn't burn the peat at all? And we heard from in the Scottish Fire and Rescue that, I think it was, or it might have been Robbie, that only 5% of fires, wildfires, are on Grousemoor, and it's the wildfires that actually potentially burn peat.
So I'm going to defer to Emma on this, because the IUCN have produced some quite useful guidance on this, but essentially we're concerned about what goes on below the ground in terms of peatlands. You know, the surface is just one indication of what's going on here. We're concerned about the drying out of the peat below the surface, but I'll defer to Emma.
Absolutely, yeah. In response to your comments around cool burns, I mean, logic would tell that, you know, putting a match to anything brings risk, and especially when our peatlands are largely in a degraded state through drainage and agricultural management, periodic burning through prescribed burning, all changes the peatland vegetation towards a drier state. So even attempting a cool burn, there is a risk when you put that match to that vegetation that you cannot control it, and because of the drier nature of the degraded peat, there is a risk it can go out of control and burn the peat. So I would like to reflect on that.
Okay. I've got Ross and then Bruce.
Thanks, Convener, and I appreciate your point about the Climate Change Committee's report, because their actual words in their 2023 report to the Parliament was that the Climate Change Committee is in the process of reviewing its previous recommendations on the practice of rotational burning, so thank you for that clarity. Just to be clear about what this does, so this will create, in effect, two licensing schemes. You'll have a licensing scheme for peatland, currently defined as where the peat is deeper than 40 centimetres, and a licensing scheme for non-peatland, which is patently everywhere else. Now, the public consultation that preceded the bill's introduction had a majority of people, again, opposed to that definition of peatland, so it's not something that's unanimously supported. And I'd come back to the point that you made, Convener. It strikes me as very illogical to regulate an above-ground activity using a below-ground metric. You know, those two things are separate. And I think we only need to look, actually, to England to see about what the potential implications of following this course of action could be. So just for everyone's awareness, in England, the heather and grass burning regulations were brought in 2021, and that will basically license the Muirburn on protected sites where the peat was deeper than 40 centimetres. So they've got a similar scheme, although it's not as kind of widely set out as what's being proposed here. And in England, the regulator has received 1,600 reports of illegal peatland burning on the back of a campaign primarily headed by the RSPB. And off those reports, that resulted in one warning letter, which was due to a technical breach, and one court case due to a misunderstanding of the regulations. So that's an attrition rate of 0.0625%. But I think the important thing to note here is that if we're going to have these continued campaigns from several environmental NGOs, which is their right to do, about kind of peatland burning, which is an inaccurate characterisation, then we're going to see vast amounts of money expended through the regulator in investigating, frankly, nonsense incidents, which just have no bearing whatsoever to the peat depth. So I really would like, I think, to put on the record as well what Professor Colin Reid said last week in responding to a question from Jim Fairley, where he did describe the measuring of peat as a problem. Those were his words. And I think, you know, it's really important that we try and ensure that this licensing scheme, when it is developed, doesn't become weaponised, because I think, frankly, that's what's happened in England, and I think the committee does need to be aware of that.
Can I bring in Emma on that specific point, and then I'll come to you.
Thank you. Yeah, I'd just like to reflect on the fact that you claim that peatland identification is an issue, because the forestry sector is able to undertake survey and definition and assessment of peat down to 10 centimetres under recent planting guidelines. So if the whole of the forestry sector across nationally in Scotland and UK-wide indeed, due to the adoption of new guidance, can manage to achieve it, then I would push back.
The difference between obviously peatland, obviously, Muirburn, which is an above-ground activity, and forestry, which involves obviously planting below the ground. I think that's where I struggle to draw the difference.
But both are looking to protect both habitats and peat soils through that activity, so I would push back again that it is a consideration of peatland as an ecosystem with above-ground vegetation and the peat soil support in that ecosystem.
Okay, thank you. Bruce.
Convener, a lot of the comments that have been made on the table are reflective of my own. However, I think the differentiation in peat depth is from my perspective, are relevant. There is evidence, perhaps not entirely empirical, but very practical, that managed cool burn, as the phrase that was used, muir burn across the surface, does not penetrate any more than a centimetre below the surface of peatland. But my concern is that if we restrict where muir burn can be carried out by bringing in a specified depth, then what we're doing is allowing a larger proportion of the fuel loading to be unmanaged. And the very thing we're trying to prevent, which is damage to the peatlands, will in fact be at higher risk, because a wildfire absolutely will damage the peatland, whereas a muir burn, whilst does carry some risk, there is never a zero risk application of fire to vegetation. So it's a smaller risk, however, because it's managed, controlled, and the phrase that's current is cool, as opposed to a very, very hot and uncontrolled wildfire.
OK, I'm going to bring in Robbie before going to Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. And I think, again, we have to be honest with ourselves that the evidence base for the benefits or disbenefits of burning on peatlands, both from a carbon lens and a nature lens, is complicated. But I'm going to take a step back and just remind ourselves, in a nature and climate crisis, where 50% of our emissions are coming from land use, and between 15 and 20% of those are coming from peatlands, the existing position that nature's got to take is that burning on peatlands is not a good idea. It is already not recommended through the Peatland Code, and this bill is providing, I think, additional safeguard to ensure that if we are going to burn on the peatland, which has to remain a tool in the toolbox, it's for very specific purposes in very specific places, and that is primarily to address the issue of wildfires getting out of hand and to protect some of our important carbon and biodiversity assets. That, for me, from the policy perspective, is absolutely sound, and it's based on the precautionary principle in light of a climate crisis.
Nick and Ross both indicated in the back of that contribution. Nick.
Thank you, Convener. We absolutely acknowledge that the science around muir burn is complex, to say the least. But where we do see a distinction in some of the differences in results from the science is where you look at the length of time in which studies have been conducted, and typically where you see negative impacts on ecosystem services through muir burn on peatlands, they tend to have been conducted over a three-year period, maybe a five-year period at best, because that reflects the funding models for most of our academic institutes in the UK. If you start to look at longer-term studies, looking at burning over an actual real-term period of a burning cycle, you start to see that over time you actually get ecosystem service benefits. And at the moment, if we look at the bill as it is being introduced, there is, and the separation of burning on peatlands and land that's not peatland, there is no provision in the bill to allow burning on peatland to deliver these ecosystem service benefits. And that, I think, will tie the Scottish Government's hands in terms of what they can do to deliver on biodiversity and climate change.
Thanks, Convener, and completely support Dr. Hesford's analysis there of the science and certainly the limitations around shorter-term studies. And those studies that use before-after control impact methodologies tend to be the ones that produce the most robust evidence. I think I was just a little bit taken aback by what I just heard from Nature Scots. I mean, I think I just need to set out very briefly, if I may, Convener, you know, what do we stand to lose if we don't properly conduct muir burn and thereby manage the wildfire risk? And, you know, I think just looking at a very brief example, Saddleworth Moor Fire in 2018, 7 centimetres of peat were lost in that fire. It will apparently take 200 years to restore that peat, and it released somewhere in the region of between 17,798 and 26,281 tonnes of carbon dioxide equivalent from the soil carbon losses, and that does not take into account the emissions from the vegetation that burned as a result as well. So I think we just need to remind ourselves, you know, about the role that burning can play when it comes to reducing fuel load, because as far as I'm concerned, it's fundamentally important.
Briefly, Emma.
Yeah, I just touched on that point, but I wanted to discuss mainly the consensus in the science, but very briefly in response to fuel load. There are other ways to manage fuel load, so I would argue that rewetting, given the Scottish Government's commitment to nature and biodiversity crisis, supporting peatland restoration, rewetting of peatlands is a major way to challenge and sort of deal with the fuel load issue. Once you rewet a peatland, within 5 to 10 years, there will be a reduction in heather cover, which reduces that fuel load issue. I could just touch very briefly on the consensus of the science. We believe that there is a consensus in the science, actually, and there have been misleading interpretations of the science repeatedly published, which fuels this lack of consensus debate we're hearing. Much of the research which you refer to in relation to long-term studies, that indicate burning is beneficial is found to be very lacking due to lack of peer review in the academic community and also huge methodological inconsistencies in defining peatland. So just in brief, much of that research produced today inconsistently and inaccurately describes the peatland type, condition and past-present management regime, and generic terms that are used in that research, such as moorland, encompassing both peat and non-peatland types, make interpretation of the science really difficult. I could just say we all agreed that a shared goal here is healthy peatlands and restoring peatlands back to health. So I think we do need some further scientific work to compare burning management and healthy peatlands rather than comparing two degraded states.
Hey, Duncan.
Yeah, I was just going to say, just referring to what Ross Ewing said there, the Nature Scott report that was published recently looking at Muir Burn and peatland said there was a lack of evidence from Scottish or UK studies that a reduction in fuel loads arising from Muir Burn influences the occurrence of wildfire on moorland, and that's a direct quote from that report. I mean, I think, you know, we're talking about a climate crisis here. 80% of our peatland resource in Scotland is damaged, and in 2019 it emitted 6.3 million tonnes of CO2, which is more than the energy supply and residential sectors. The Scottish Government is investing £250 million in restoring peatlands, and there is evidence now, growing evidence, including from Saddleworth Moor, actually, in England, and our neighbouring reserve there at Dovestone, that actually restored habitats are more resilient to wildfire than non-restored habitats. And actually, we found that also in the flow country of Forsenada. There's about to be some papers published from the University of Highlands and Islands, which will make that very point.
Nick. Then Ross, and then we'll need to move on.
Thanks, Convener. And to save this committee the experience of two academics butting heads over this, the back and forth there between Emma and I does illustrate quite clearly how complex the issue is and really highlights the need for an adaptive management approach going forward. On the point that Emma made on alternatives to Muir Burn, they are untested. If you think that the science on Muir Burn and the environmental impacts is complex, and requires more study, then there is even less science on rewetting and there is even less science on cutting. Rewetting, for example, has been suggested to be able to increase flood risk through things like saturated overland flow, which essentially when you get a saturated peatland, you get heavy rain, you see increased risk of flooding, but also it poses an increased risk of methane emissions. Methane is 80 times more damaging in a climate context than carbon. And so whilst we think these are cutting and rewetting are important management tools, they shouldn't be prioritised over Muir Burn. They should all be in one toolbox and they should be reviewed in an adaptive management context.
And briefly, Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Duncan's assessment there, or characterisation of the Nature Scott report, he actually missed out quite an important detail, which is where they said that there was a, quote, plausible mechanism through which the intensity of wildfire could be influenced as a result of controlled burning. And indeed, I'd refer the committee as well to Professor Newton's remarks from last week, where he said all the big ones, we're talking about wildfire, have been on areas that have not been burned for several decades. So there's a huge build-up of dry trash on the ground to get the fire going. And I completely support rewetting as an endeavour, as a tool in the box for managing wildfire mitigation. But I think we all need to be clear that it's not on its own going to cut it. And actually the fact that we've seen wildfire kind of engulfing places such as Forsenard and Dovestone that RSPB manage, just shows that rewetting perhaps on its own just isn't quite cutting it, Convener.
Yeah, Bruce.
My points have largely made, Convener. Emma's absolutely right that rewetting is a valuable tool in the box. But as both Nick and Ross have said, it's not the only tool in the box. It's perhaps not the most effective tool in the box. Wildfire will damage wetland and can and does every year. Cutting is absolutely a tool that can be used, but it essentially creates a dry litter layer that fire will spread through. Burning is the most effective, although the most risky approach to fuel management.
Okay, thank you.
Originally asked, I mean, how could would it there not be a circumstance where Nature Scott could make a differential between a non-peatland and a peatland in terms of when issuing a licence without there being two licensing systems?
So, on receipt of any application, Rachel, for a piece of land, we would expect an applicant to be able to be clear about why they're burning, where they're burning, and what controls are in place, and that can include peatland and non-peatland habitats. but the purpose will be different because it's different in the legislation. So we need to be really clear that if you are going to be burning on peatland, it is under exceptional circumstances, and it is quite clearly for the purpose explained in the bill. Yeah, just coming back to that discussion about the importance of the peatland resource, whilst I understand the debate about how this plays out in practice on grouse moors, most of the peatland resource in Scotland, it's not on the monoliths and the cairngorms and the Angus Glens and the southern uplands and South Perthshire, which is where most muir burn happens for grouse purposes. It's in the north and west. So the conflict between peatland as a resource and a muir burn for grouse moors seems to be dominating this discussion, but in actual fact, quite a lot of the peatland resource are in areas out with grouse moors where there's still muir burn occurring and where we need to make sure we get adequate controls. I just thought that's a point worth making.
Can I just apologise? Did I jump into Alistair's questioning? Sorry.
I think Ariane had a question as well. I think that's been covered as well. So I'm going to move on to a question from Karen, who is just going to probably explore that a little bit further.
Yeah, it'll probably just take a little bit more because I have gone quite a bit in depth here, excusing any puns, but just to dig in a little more to the definition of peat and peatland, just asking opinions on the definition of that and for the purpose, obviously, of muir burn licensing, what the individual witnesses' thoughts are on that.
Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Karen, in response to your question, that I'd refer again to last week's remarks from Professor Newton, which I thought were quite instructive in this point, where he kind of talked about one licensing scheme covering the lot. And I think that's really important because from our perspective, we do not think that the mechanisms for determining peat depth will provide sufficient certainty to land managers, and ultimately the provisions of the bill currently would technically, you know, make it an offence to make an erroneous submission. You know, and if you've not followed the methodology to the letter, then there is a real risk, I suppose, of you being prosecuted or caught out by the legislation. So the fact that we don't have a methodology to actually scrutinise here is a big part of the problem. You know, and so I think on that basis we would advocate for a licensing scheme which kind of removes the peatland licensing scheme in toto. So you've got one licensing scheme with the broadest range of licensable purposes, but you've still got Nature Scot kind of applying its discretion perhaps in those areas where the peat is that little bit deeper, if that's its concern. And I think one of the principal motivations of this convener, I must set out, which is really important, is that paragraph 202 of the Molesey Memorandum acknowledges that national survey data for peat measured at 40 centimetres does not exist. And that massively exacerbates the uncertainty for land managers. And I think it's really important and quite instructive, actually, that during the development of the heather and grass regulations in 2021, one of the foremost things that the Secretary of State did before he actually pushed the green button on those regulations was ensuring that on designated sites that there was peat mapping data there at 40 centimetres. And I think that's absolutely fundamental. But if we're going to be absolutely pushing this narrative that we need to have a peatland licensing scheme based on some measure of peat depth, because the data exists at the 50 centimetres threshold, our strongest view is that really it should be at 50 centimetres. And Professor Werity said last week, you know, the existing map is based on 50 centimetres, and if you migrate away from that, then clearly you have a challenge in how you determine that. And he also went on to say that developing that new national data set at 40 centimetres would be a major undertaking to effectively remap Scotland's peat soils. And the final thing, Camilla, just before I finish, is that I draw your attention, as also all committee members, to the 40th report of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, which states in relation to the ability for Scottish ministers to amend the definition of peat and peatland via the affirmative procedure that, and I quote, it considers that any change to this provision may merit greater parliamentary scrutiny than just the affirmative procedure.
Thank you. Emma.
Just to reflect a little bit on Ross's point there, I agree completely that the mapping data is very, very challenging, and you will never get a map that is perfect on the ground. It will always need to be ground-toothed and checked, which means that there will be a requirement for practitioners and landowners to go out and do that survey. And there are several easy, accessible tools in the box, such as using Munsell colour charts, Vonpost soil texture, vegetation indicators, peat depth probes, etc. But just reflecting back on your question, Karen, about the depth definition as well, the classification of peat has led to shallow areas of degraded peat being completely excluded from policy and land management decisions, and that is quite a major concern. So I would certainly welcome a more holistic look and a move away from an arbitrary depth definition in relation to peat. And I certainly welcomed Nick's comments earlier about that sort of more holistic approach, looking at the ecology and hydrology of the system rather than an arbitrary depth being applied to that.
Nick.
Well,
So I was going to reiterate that point, so thank you, Emma. But we would agree with Ross in terms of, in the absence of better data, retaining a 50-centimetre peak depth definition should be adequate for now, and that remapping that could easily happen through an adaptive management approach where land managers are taking measurements in the field, similar to what Emma is talking about there, and those data could feed into the redefining that. In fact, that is happening already on Scottish uplands, and those, as I said before, those data are currently sitting with GWCT.
Duncan.
So very briefly, as a landowner, land manager that is already doing peatland code work, and where we're doing the kind of testing, you know, of peatland depths that Emma's just described, there is an easily and readily accessible method for doing this. There's also a development method that's used in relation to wind farms and that kind of thing. But just for us, you know, now that, and like a lot of landowners, we're moving into developing peatland code applications and that kind of thing, some consistency would help us. So that is why we would advocate a 30-centimetre depth. And that's what the peatland, the National UK Peatland Strategy also says. We would appreciate that kind of consistency. I mean, the Forestry Commission, or Forestry and Land Scotland, Forestry Scotland, actually use a 10-centimetre peatland depth. So, you know, we argue, go with where the sort of consensus seems to be across the peatland community.
Beatrice Wishart.
Yeah, can I address my question to Robbie, please? Could you describe what methodology might be used to determine if a piece of land is peatland? And how do you think stakeholders could be supported in the sort of practicalities of that?
Well, it's fascinating to hear the discussion so far, because we do understand the need to provide prescription and detail, and that was part of the discussion at last week's committee about the need for flexibility within the system versus very hard prescribed targets. So there are a range of tools out there, as Emma's suggested, which will help illustrate peak depth, and the most simple one of which actually is just a probe, a peat probe, which is becoming much more commonly used for restoration work and is something practitioners can use. I think there's a point of first principles I'll come back to as well here. If you are going to go and burn an area of peatland in a climate and nature crisis where the peatland resource is so important, I would ask why you're proposing to do that without really understanding what's going on under the surface. And that is not an unreasonable expectation of an applicant to be able to demonstrate they have knowledge of that. We don't have the data nationally. It's always going to be really hard to get that data nationally. Therefore, there will be an onus on an applicant to be able to demonstrate they've got an understanding that the right safeguards are in place. But I suppose, again, I'll come back to first principles. We're in a climate crisis. We are expecting transformative land use. Now, this has changed, and I accept people will struggle with it. But from our point of view, we are not going to get to net zero unless people start changing behaviour. And burning is absolutely part of that. Protecting our peatland resources is part of that, which is why Scottish Government are putting £250 million into addressing some of the damage and modification that has gone on to lead to peatlands being in poor condition. So the last thing we would like to see is any applications coming forward which risks that any more than we've already got.
Do you believe that the bill as drafted is flexible enough to be adapted to new science and changing ground conditions?
Yeah, I mean, again, in applying a licensing regime, come back to better regulation here, we will need to continue to refine that as our knowledge improves. And there are gaps in our knowledge, and quite a lot of the data we will secure as a result of the licensing returns and the data coming in will help plug those gaps. So we are on an adaptive management journey to think about how we best protect our natural assets.
Okay, Ross and then Nick.
Thanks, Convener. And just following on from Robbie's comments, I completely accept the points. We are in a climate and biodiversity emergency, but we're also in a just transition, and I think the onus is on us to ensure that, you know, land managers actually have the tools at their disposal to be able to go out and do what government is asking of them properly. So I think the 50-centimetre depth base would not be unreasonable, given we have that data available. And secondly, you know, there's been a lot of talk about the use of peat probes, which I understand are very simple to use, but the Nature Scot review of off Muirburn last year noted that there is, however, a constraint with this method in terms of the time required to carry out surveys survey, which will depend on the scale involved and the level of and detail required. Now, clearly, in the context of our larger land holdings, that presents a significant challenge. So we would massively welcome much more greater information, I suppose, at this stage about what sort of kind of methodology will be used for determining the peat depth, because that is a clear kind of vacant area within the bill at the moment. But would certainly kind of echo the sentiments about the climate and nature emergencies and the importance, I suppose, of managing fuel load on peatland to protect it for years to come.
Nick.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to pick up on the point of peat probes as well. We acknowledge the methodological limitations of using peat probes, but they do provide a quick and easy assessment of peat depth, although that's not it is subject to some issues. The land holdings we're talking about, as Ross mentioned, can be quite extensive, and therefore peat probe survey across even the whole of a hillside would still leave large areas either categorised as peatland or not under the current way it's laid out in the bill, based on the simple resolution in which you can probe. Therefore, we would advocate for ignition point recording and an adaptive management. So collect that data over time and let us learn from it.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to move on to wildfire, given that one of the purposes for which a licence can be sought is to manage the risk of wildfire. I know we touched on it earlier, but can I ask Robbie, is Nature Scot confident that you'll be able to assess the wildfire risk for the purposes of granting licences?
That's quite a difficult question to answer, Convener. But again, coming back down to first principles, we know Muirburn as a tool has to remain absolutely an integral part of our ability to reduce the risk of wildfire. So again, I just need to make that point absolutely clear. It has to remain a tool in the toolbox. And the main reason on peatland habitats and other habitats is to try and protect our assets. And that does require a bit of strategic planning about where we're going to burn and how best to burn to try and reduce the risk of wildfire. But again, the onus on that actually is in an applicant to be able to demonstrate that in their view, on their property, this is the most sensible place to do it. Because, you know, let's be honest, owner-occupiers know their ground better than we do. So the onus is actually on an applicant to be able to demonstrate in this case, we think these are the areas that need to be burnt to protect and to deliver on the core purposes in the bill. So it's very much a joint consideration. And again, coming back to our relationship with applicants based on trust and confidence.
So turning it on its head, so we're talking currently about landowners actively seeking a licence to reduce wildfire risk. If we turn on its head, is there a need for some legislation to force landowners to assess wildfire risk and be forced then to take appropriate action? That might well be to Muirburn to reduce the fuel load. Because that was, and the basis of asking this question is because there was a suggestion that the fire up in Inverness, somebody should be held account for not managing that fuel load, which was ultimately at some point going to lead to a wildfire.
So again, I think just taking a step back, the context in which we're operating and expecting to see an extra 1 degree between now and 2050 in Scotland means that wildfire risk is heightened and is going to continue to heighten. We have hosted European delegates, both from forestry and nature conservation agencies in Scotland over the last 2 or 3 weeks. And in many of those countries, wildfire risk is the single biggest issue they are faced with in terms of protecting forests and peatland soils. The reason I highlight that again is that it is increasingly important for land managers, both of forests and peatland resources, to strategically think about how best to protect those stocks and wildfire being one of the tools. Not the only tool by any way stretch of the imagination. So it is, again, just asking people to think much more differently in light of a climate crisis, in light of changed environmental conditions, in light of increased risk of fire, how we mitigate those risks.
Okay, I'm going to ask Bruce, if you will do risk assessments as part of your role, so that's buildings or activities or whatever, do you think you should be carrying out risk assessments on moorland or grassland and you have potentially powers to make a landowner take action to reduce that wildfire risk?
The duty to carry out a risk assessment is the landowners rather than the fire services. So if we use the context of buildings as an illustrator, the risk assessment for this building is the responsibility of the duty holder, and that can be either the owner or somebody who's delegated that authority. Similarly, in the rural environment, there absolutely needs to be an assessment of risk, whether that be for new plantations or whether it be for established sporting estates or crofts or farms. And that assessment should be not just for the here and now, but for the lifespan of that plantation or for the next 10, 20, 30 years. There's need to revisit it, absolutely, and there's need to make sure that it is aligned to guidance that is given as to what the risk assessment should contain. We currently have the powers for buildings to assess the risk assessment and identify whether it is suitable or not, but we are not the enforcing agency in relation to that. Similarly, in the wildfire context, we would be able to assess whether our risk assessment is suitable or not. Whether we should be the enforcing authority is a separate debate. But the risk assessment, in my view, should be the primary factor to decide what land management activity is carried out and when, rather than arbitrary figures such as depth of peat. But the fuel management is the key bit. That's the bit that will burn first and possibly give cause to the peat being burnt afterwards. So the risk assessment is a key part in that, in my opinion.
OK, thank you. Ross Shear.
Thanks, Convener. Just to say that Scottish Land Estates support our members in terms of developing integrated wildfire management plans and also placing their resources, if they feel they're able to, on the Community Asset Register, which allows them to be used by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in the incident of a wildfire taking hold. I just want to draw the committee's attention to two key problems as we see it surrounding wildfire with a bill. So the first is the presumption that exists against Muirburn on peatland, which basically says that Scottish ministers may grant a licence where the licence relates to peatland if they are satisfied that no other method of vegetation control is available. Now, we think that carries catastrophic consequences, not least because what it does is it ultimately prioritises other methods of vegetation control, the most obvious one being cutting. Now, incidentally, with cutting using a flail mower, that's a land management technique that we know even less about than Muirburn in terms of its impact on the peatland below. So I think I'd strongly urge caution about prioritising that. But I think in our view that that provision around kind of prioritising other methods of vegetation control over Muirburn needs to just be removed from the bill. And the second point to note is that the bill is completely silent on the issue of backburning. Now, backburning, for those that are unaware, is a tool that's employed, it's a type of Muirburn essentially, that's employed during a wildfire incident to ultimately get rid of the fuel load in front of the fire. This bill is completely silent on that, but it was, you know, backburning has been commended in two such parliamentary motions this year, one from Fergus Ewing and one from Kate Forbes, and indeed was used quite extensively, as I understand it, during the Cannock wildfire, which took place over the last few weeks. So just to set that out, there doesn't appear to be any provision made, Convener, for backburning in this bill whatsoever.
OK, and you bring in Nick.
Thanks, Convener. I wanted to come in again on the points Ross made on alternatives to Muirburn and the fact that they are not tested, and therefore we would support what SLE are saying in terms of removing that, that section of the bill. If you look at things like re-wetting, it stands to reason that a wetter bog may stop a fire, and you know, the science suggests that during prescribed burns, a re-wetted moor, you know, an area of wetter moorland could stop the fire. But though that's prescribed burns, which happen October to April during a cooler period. If you've got a wildfire, they predominantly happen in the summer, where the water table, even on the most ecologically intact and well-functioning bog, can drop by up to 30 centimetres. So these, just because a bog's being re-wetted doesn't mean that it doesn't pose a risk to wildfire.
Okay. In the interest of time, I'm going to bring in Rhoda Grant, who's got a further question on wildfire, then I'll bring in the other stakeholders. Rhoda.
Thank you. My question's for Bruce Fackerson. You said in your evidence before that Muirburn was one of the most effective, although riskiest, form of managing wildfire. Is there anything else from your experience that would be useful? Any other tools that would be useful in doing this? And also whether you think the regulatory framework is appropriately designed for that kind of activity?
Thank you for the question. I think there are other tools definitely for managing fuel, and a few have been mentioned today. In my opinion, and in what I have seen when I've gone around the country and spoken with various people, Muirburn is definitely the most effective because it removes the fuel in its entirety. Cutting is effective to a point, but I use the analogy quite regularly of attending a fire in the house of a hoarder rather than a fire in the house of a minimalist. The cutting would leave that dry layer that actually encourages the spread of fire. Now, cutting is used to control Muirburn, but when that is the case, the cut material is still wet, and that's the key part. When it's allowed to dry out, you have that fine fuel moisture, fine fuel underneath the top vegetation layers, and that propagates and encourages fire.
Rewetting is absolutely a tool, it's a long-term tool, but again, as has been said a number of times today, the science is conflicting on that, and there's a bit of work required there. Similarly, variegated planting of species has a demonstrable impact on how fire will spread rather than having a continuity of similar fuels. But muir burn is absolutely the most effective way of removing the fuel, which then manages the landscape and prevents the wildfire from happening. I think the legislation, as laid out, has a critical omission, and it's a requirement for training to be mandatory for anybody that's going to apply a flame to vegetation. Given that we've mentioned a few times today how risky that activity is, to have that completely untrained and no input given as to how that can be carried out safely seems to me to be quite an omission.
Okay. Should there be a duty on people to manage that fuel load? You talked about, you know, in public buildings, there's a duty of people to mitigate fire risk. Should there be a duty on land managers to mitigate fire risk?
Yes, is the short answer, yes.
I'm going to bring in Miranda, Duncan and then Ross.
Yes, I wanted to say something about the fact that what we've heard here is that a lot of, well, some of the key resources, like the peat, is in the Crofting Counties. We've seen some of the recent wildfires were in the Crofting Counties. But actually, when we were looking at sort of the way this bill has progressed and some of the reports that were underpinning it, it was very little recognition for Crofting. I don't think it was mentioned once. We, as a small organisation, we're trying to fill that gap here, but I think there needs to be a lot more done. We can facilitate that to engage with people on the ground who are actually using fire to better understand what the practices are there, so we can better engage with this. Ultimately, how are they able to identify their areas? I'm hearing fire management plans. How applicable are those in a small context? How accessible does fire remain as a tool? If indeed we see some of these measures being brought in, that might be better suited for larger land managers. And then on the point of alternatives, we are also very keen to understand this better. We have actually proposed in our evidence that we would like to see some kind of programme of support for exploring these alternatives, also grazing being one of them. And I just want to place this debate also in that wider context. The fact that what we are seeing right now is that, for example, the common grazings, which are such an important area when we're discussing these issues, is really, really under-supported when it comes to actually making sure that we have livestock within these areas. We had a recent case just a month ago in Lewis where we had a fire that got out of control, was instigated in someone's garden, but got into a field of rank vegetation and got out of control very quickly. And then it hit a well-grazed common grazings and it stopped. But that is kind of, in some areas, the exception to the rule. We're seeing common grazings that are increasingly neglected, where there is no support anymore for under environment schemes to have bracken control, for example, a lack of support for people to have livestock on the hill, no use of chemicals. So this will be the next thing. So yes, absolutely, to some degree, there's a responsibility on land managers to manage those fuel loads, but we have to look at the tools that we have in the box and that are currently already being restricted for different reasons, and then see how Murban fits into that.
Okay, thank you. Duncan.
Yeah, I think another consideration here, I mean, recognising all of us here want to prevent wildfire, but we may have different ways of going about it. And, you know, I mean, the approach that if there was a duty on managing fuel load that required people to burn or remove excess fuel, that sort of, you know, builds on the history of the approach that we've had over many years. I mean, many of our landscapes, in the uplands in particular, are damaged because of centuries of overburning and overgrazing, which has promoted vegetation, which is fire-prone, like heather, millennia grasses. You know, longer term, if we want to take a, you know, longer term and create more resilience to wildfire in our landscapes, we've got to look at creating more diverse upland landscapes, which include native woodland, which include restored peat bogs, and which are more resilient to wildfire. So we've got to build in the short-term as well as long-term thinking.
On the Emma as well, there was a mention of forestry earlier and the depth. In terms of emission, I mean, there's been a huge issue around forestry being planted in peatland. And if we're talking about climate change here and carbon sequestration, You know, in terms of regeneration, heather growth, regeneration, habitat species and recovery, there is much more quicker recovery and carbon sequestration in the use of Mirburn than ever there will be in terms of forestry. Well, I mean, I'm looking at, you know, I'm speaking with the Woodland Trust, who are concerned about this, that there are people in the southwest that are talking about the emissions and the impacts that planting forestry in peatland is having, whether it is to 30 centimetres. But on the point that we're making here around this sort of, there's almost an argument that's going on about climate change and, you know, biodiversity. I think the both go hand in hand. And from what I'm hearing and seeing on Monday, that Mirburn is creating habitat, but it is also, you know, sequestering carbon. And that doesn't seem to be the position that RSPB is. But also on the point that Bruce is making around the fire, the wildfires, I mean, would you say that the fire would have had, you know, the impact of that wildfire would have been had less of an impact if there had been Mirburn, you know, in practice on those particular areas?
I mean, we've got a climate and nature emergency. I mean, I very much agree with what Robbie said earlier. I mean, that has got to be our priority now. You know, the best outcome for climate and biodiversity are more heterogeneous habitats in our uplands, which would include more native woodland. There's a very useful JHI report which sets out the role that native woodland regeneration, for example, can play in terms of sequestering carbon in our uplands. I mean, one of the big issues that we have at the present time is that large areas, I mean, some will dispute the figures, but people say, you know, between 10 and 20% of Scotland's land area is managed as grouse moor. A lot of that area is, you are preventing succession by the land management natural succession of woodland vegetation and other scrub vegetation that would take place in the absence of Mirburn. So, you know, longer term, we need more. It's widely recognised that we need more woodland in terms of meeting the carbon challenge. And some of that is going to have to be on grouse moors. In fact, some grouse moors are already putting in new native woodlands around grouse moors.
I think we're now drifting away. But
can I just get the answer
topic?
On? I know I did.
I'm very conscious. On the session load, should have finished 20 minutes ago.
Can
so
I just get the answer on the fuel load from
absolutely
the RSPB?
So around, specifically about fuel load.
Yeah.
So for us, you know, the way we manage our land, we are trying to create more resilience in the habitats that we have on our land to mitigate against wildfire, and that's largely, I mean, we have a lot of peat bogs on our land, many of which, you know, have been degraded before we acquired the sites. We're investing hugely in peatland restoration. At other sites, we're putting in, you know, native woodland or encouraging native woodland.
But in Spain, wetting peatland has been found that wildfires are going to occur because of drought.
But Spain is very different from the UK. We have a completely different climate here. I mean,
but we're looking at...
Okay, I'm going to move. We're getting into the minutiae of the topic. I think we need to just be conscious of time. I'm going to bring in Christine Graham on wildfires.
Yes, I'm looking at the licensing, and it says licensing where they're satisfied that Mirburn is necessary and no other method of vegetation control is available. I would have prepared the word appropriate. Appropriate or practicable. The second thing is, I think you mentioned training, and I would ask if under licensing, one of the questions that would be asked is what training has been undertaken on the estate with regard to the various methods. I think it was a very good point, but you wouldn't put that in primary legislation. But it might be a question that the license provider would ask of that, to ensure that even when they're granting it, the people who are exercising the licence know how to appropriately do it.
Yeah, just if I may respond on those points, absolutely. One of the questions we must pose is, why burning in the absence of alternatives? I don't think that's an unreasonable question, and I'm sure there'll be lots of answers why burning is the most appropriate method.
Appropriate's a better one.
And secondly, on standards and training, yeah, we're working quite hard to make sure those people who are undertaking this activity are appropriately trained. That is on the face of the bill, and I think it's incumbent upon us and Scottish Fire Rescue Service and practitioners to make sure we set that bar in the right place, recognising actually that standards and skills appropriate on grouse moors, who are exemplary in the field of managing fire. We've got to try and think about the consistency of standards about how that squares with crofting communities and farmers who have not got the same resources or skills.
Yeah.
And we would like to see the standards raised, consistently applied, so we are assured that the safeguards are in place.
Forgive me, I haven't got the bill in front of me. Is the word available on the bill rather than appropriate?
I think it says available in the bill just now, but I
don't think that's the right word.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Bruce and then Ross to bring this section to a close.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to go back to the points that were made by Rachel earlier on and in relation to the would the wildfire have reacted differently, I think, a landscape that we managed by Muirburn. And we'll go back to what Nick said earlier on, that interconnected mosaic of burning presents a fantastic opportunity for the firefighters to actually either put in a fire break or mount an attack from a portion of land they know is safe from the fire coming onto. So in relation to how a wildfire will progress across an area that has been managed via Muirburn, it's very different when the fuel has been managed in that way and allows us a great opportunity to deal with the fire. And it was mentioned that the context of our climate is very different to that of Spain, and it absolutely is at the moment. But in 2018, we had a man called Mark Castelnau, who is a worldwide recognised expert in relation to wildfire, who's based in Catalonia. And at the Scottish Wildfire Conference in Edinburgh in 2018, he stated that in his research and opinion, the wildfire context within Scotland would be similar to that experienced in Portugal within the next 30 years. But by context, Portugal lose hundreds of people to wildfires every year. Now, what we need to do is identify what we can do now to prevent us getting to that point. And in Spain, the reintroduction of prescribed burning is absolutely part of the arsenal they're using. And we're seeing that in Australia and California, with other countries that have a significant wildfire problem. So it's the management of the fuel that is key to prevent us getting to the point that Portugal finds itself in right now, where wildfires are uncontrollable and present a real and significant threat to life.
Thank you. And very briefly, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. I wholly endorse what Bruce has just said. Just a point of concern that's been raised by some of our members who are undertaking peatland restoration, which is something we fully obviously support and something we need to be doing. There is concern among some members about the risk posed by an increased fuel load build-up as a result of the provisions in this bill, about their investment that they've obviously put into peatland restoration, and indeed the vast amounts of public money that have gone into it as well. So just a note to say that, you know, the implications of this bill will carry implications also for things like peatland restoration, which clearly a lot of people have invested money in, a lot of the public purse has been used on that. I think it's important that we, you know, make sure that this bill adequately provides resilience for our landscapes to protect it from wildfire risk.
Thank you. We're now going to look at the role of Nature Scott, and a question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Just really to ask about resources, and we've heard a bit about the kind of tasks that Nature Scott would face in licensing Muirburn. What are the implications for resource for your own organisation, and are you in a position that you're confident about being able to meet the requirement?
So what we've tried to do, both in the financial memorandum and in discussion with sponsor colleagues in Scottish Government, is be clear on the transactional nature of these new licences. So we've tried to quantify that as far as we are able, but quite a lot of this activity is unregulated just now, so it's very difficult to be absolutely specific about who's going to come forward with applications and how well-informed those applications are going to be. So it comes back down to the point about trying to ensure that we are adequately resourced to deal with that demand, and that's an ongoing conversation we're having with Scottish Government, that as this bill progresses, that we've got reassurance that we can deal with probably what will amount to between 500 and 800 new licence applications on an annual basis.
Probably how compliance with the Muirburn Code and other licensing conditions will be monitored.
So monitoring and enforcement and compliance is going to be pretty fundamental to this. Comes back down to resourcing, actually. We know that compliance monitoring is going to be key to make sure that we take that adaptive management approach and learn from experience. So we can draw some reassurance that as technology improves, we can use very efficient means of monitoring burning as part of our compliance condition. We're still operating on the basis of trust and confidence that we're getting returns and information about how well licences are being complied with. But we will need to secure enough resource for us to be able to go out and spot check from time to time and ground truth that licences are actually being complied with and that will form part of the ongoing drive for improvement as we move forward in this space.
Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. There are stakeholders who suggested there's broad discretion for Nature Scotland granting and making decisions around issuing, suspending or revoking licences. So what does Nature Scotland see as its role, and how will you ensure you take a proportionate approach?
So proportionality, again, common theme through the discussions today. All I think I can do is provide some reassurance to committee that in pursuing both a licensing approach, which will be informed by a framework about how we expect applicants to come forward with applications, about how we monitor compliance, and indeed how any sanctions would apply in practice, that's a commitment that we work together to do that. We've given that commitment to develop the code. We've got that experience about how frameworks work previously. So I am hoping to provide you with reassurance that as a public body, we are accountable and the safeguards are in place, both in legislation and indeed us as a public body, that if people are not happy, they've got an opportunity to appeal decisions, which is on the face of this bill. We would impose it anyway, just through our desire to be, exemplars of the better regulation agenda. We're subject to public service ombudsman complaints and indeed ultimately judicial review if people are not happy with how we're conducting our regulatory functions. So that's as much safeguard as I can provide committee today.
Thank you.
Peter, just to say that there is significant concern from land managers, particularly around the notion of kind of ascertaining peat depth, which is clearly something that Nature Scotland is going to want to try and monitor. We feel it'd be really important that there could be some sort of provision included that says it would not be an offence to make a false declaration when applying for a licence to make beerburn on peatland, provided the methodology was followed. Because as we've just heard, peat depth can be hugely variable. And how do we know that, you know, the same bit of land, for example, that Nature Scotland come and probe when they do their assurance check is the same bit of land that was probed when a land manager did their survey, if that's what's required. There really does need to be some consistency and clarity here. I 100% support the point that Nick Hesford raised about the ignition points being the point at which you actually do that measurement, because that at least provides you with a little bit of clarity. The point at which the fire starts is the point at which you measure, and that would make it much easier for land managers to follow alongside that provision.
Thank you. And finally, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I think that follows on great from there. Stakeholders have suggested the need for adaptive management as new science becomes available. So to ask Nature Scotland, how will you ensure that this new information is reflected in decision making and new guidance around licensing?
We fully appreciate, because we've heard already that there is so much uncertainty in the evidence base and what is a new regulated framework that we need to learn by doing, and there will be some risks inherent in amongst all of that, both for practitioners and indeed for us as a regulator. So come back to first principles that we have signed something called the shared practice for best practice for wildlife management, which is about really, it's again about working together, about good communication, about transparency in the evidence base, and a desire to continue to improve. That's how we work as a regulator, and again with representative bodies round this virtual table and others through the Moorland Forum. That's how we would expect to behave moving forward.
And very briefly, Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. This is to RSPB, and it's about at the moment the season is going to be until April, and I understand that you have some concerns about that, and it would be interesting to hear that.
Yeah, so just in relation to the muirburn season, particularly the spring end, which is clearly when birds are starting to breed, the current provisions in the bill set out a end of muirburn season date of 15th of April, by which time many moorland birds are already breeding. And looking again at the climate change predictions, the bird breeding seasons are coming forward by a day every 8 years as a result of climate change. So we can expect that trend of earlier breeding of moorland birds to increase. Now, ideally, we would suggest that an end of muirburn season of the 15th of March would be more appropriate than 15th of April. By the 15th of March, birds like golden eagles, for example, have started breeding in late March. Many wading birds have started breeding as well, including red-listed species that are concerned, and you know, this is climate and nature crisis, remember, here as well. So the compromise might be the 31st of March, but for us, the 15th of April is too late.
Okay. Can I bring in Nick and then Ross?
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to draw the committee at this point to draw your attention at least to the British Trust for Ornithology report that was published in 2021, which looked at breeding bird laying dates, and it confirmed what Duncan's saying in terms of laying dates are advancing. But despite this, it concluded that there is little overlap between the current birding seasons and the nesting attempts of most upland bird species. It also concluded that overall there is a very low risk for populations of upland species from Yerburn. And those species where there is a greater overlap, things like golden eagle, there are other provisions in the code which put a buffer around areas where they are breeding. And for species which are at risk potentially because of a greater overlap, like lapwing and golden plover, they don't nest on rank heather anyway, so you wouldn't expect to see any damage from that point of view.
Okay, and I think Duncan wanted to come in the back.
Final point on this is we get reports every year from members of the public concerned about Muirburn having burned out bird nests. So, you know, this is a real issue.
Okay, Ross, yeah.
Just to make quite an obvious point, you know, it doesn't serve the interest of a grouse moor manager to burn out nests because clearly you're trying to produce grouse, which are ground nesting birds. So just to make that kind of obvious point, and also to say that I think the far greater risk to ground nesting birds comes from excessive fuel load build-up. And indeed, we've seen the dreadful incident at Cannock. Goodness knows the amount of ground nesting birds that probably perished during that wildfire. So just to make that point that I think, you know, we've got bigger problems than just the Muirburn season to worry about here.
Beatrice Wishart.
Yeah, it's a final question actually for Emma. It's a yes or no answer. Is IUCN involved in the drawing up of the draft statutory guidance on Muirburn?
No, I actually requested to Nature Scott just yesterday actually for a place at the table to help with the Muirburn Code. We have been involved in Muirburn Code drafts previously and we would very much welcome the opportunity to feed in. We would like the Muirburn Code to be drafted with a sound scientific evidence base and both panel with scientific members and practitioners. I think that's really important to have that communication and partnership across the two elements.
Thank you. That concludes our evidence sessions this morning. I'm going to suspend the meeting very briefly to allow witnesses to leave. We have further items on the agenda, so I'm going to ask committee members to stay in their positions. Thank you. Our next item is consideration of three negative SSIs. And first, we have the Public Intervention and Private Storage Aid Suspension and Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2023. Do members wish to make any recommendations on the instrument? No. Rachel Hamilton.
Convener, can I just draw your attention to the comments from the NFUS on this particular SSI, and I just want to confirm that it is 2023-150. Correct. Yes. The NFUS acknowledged the importance of having a framework for market support during crisis situations, expressed concern causing caution regarding the potential impact of proposed changes on stability and confidence in various sectors. And they also stated that with the up-and-coming agricultural bill, that it would provide adequate powers for Scottish ministers to intervene when necessary. I'm not minded to put a motion forward to annul this, but I think once again we find ourselves in a situation, convener, where quite a considerable body representing quite a number of farmers are sharing caution with this committee, and I seek your advice.
I echo the views of Rachel Hamilton. It's concerning that the NFUS have raised concerns. However, they believe that the agriculture bill would offer the adequate provision. I'm not aware of any draft agriculture bill or any provisions within that, but it would appear that the NFUS have had sight of the agriculture bill to give them that comfort. That concerns me, that we are potentially making a decision without knowing whether a forthcoming bill will actually mitigate the concerns that they have. My other comments are that this is suggests there's that the private intervention ceased to have effect in Scotland for a period of 5 years, but no impact assessment has been made because it was for a temporary period. I would have thought that 5 years is a fairly extended temporary period, and an impact assessment should have been carried out. 5 years is a long time, so I have concerns that there's not more details on that. I think today we could write on the back of those concerns, but otherwise, are we content to... Rhoda?
Just my reading of the regulations was that this instrument, if something happened, it could be brought back into force, and the 5 years was to allow for the Agriculture Bill to make provision that would take over from the instrument. So I think those maybe ask for confirmation that that is the case, but also when we're looking at the Agriculture Bill, to make a note of this for our looking at that bill to make sure it does what we assume is the plan.
Absolutely. I think particularly given that it does state that it could leave Scottish applicants at a disadvantage if we didn't mirror the rest of the UK, when the temporary PI provision ceases. So I think we certainly need to write on the back of that. Today, really, the option we have is either to annul or to say we're content, but write to the Scottish Government with seeking further clarity. Are we content to do that? Rachel Hamilton.
Is it possible, without annulling, to seek clarity? Because also, I mean, on the policy note, it says that if Scotland do not choose to mirror the rest of the UK, it leaves Scottish applicants at a disadvantage. But how does the NFUS not take that same view?
Just practicalities, the reporting deadline is the 26th of June, so today would be the last opportunity for us to deal with it.
Can we write?
We can write, but it would be, the instrument would come into force on the 1st of July.
Okay, so when did how long have we had with this instrument?
We've had 40 days.
Okay, that's the first I've seen it, sorry.
Okay, are we content to write with our concerns relating to this, but Alistair Allen?
Yeah, I'm content with that approach. I don't sense there's a movement to annul, but just to get a clearer idea of what the letter to the government would say, or what the tone of what the content of it would be.
Yeah, certainly. I think we need clarity on why the NFUS have been given a comfort that the forthcoming agriculture bill will actually offer adequate provision for the Scottish Government to intervene where necessary. I'm not aware, and I haven't seen a draft of the agriculture bill, so I can't have any comfort that that's the case, but the NFUS appear to have, so I'd like to find out.
They appear to have been given comfort on that point, which isn't the same as them having seen the bill.
No, they've been the assurances, and I assume these assurances will be something that the government or any government can't renege on. They've obviously been in discussions with
But what I mean is that's not the same as having been shown the bill.
Yeah. I don't think they've seen a bill.
My point is that I don't have any comfort or reassurance from anywhere that the agricultural bill will offer the adequate provisions of giving Scottish ministers power. So, to make a decision on that, I would find difficult because I don't have any reassurance that will be the case. I'm also concerned that there was no risk assessment based on a potential five-year period, which I would suggest is slightly longer than I would consider temporary.
I think for
that's just the right to the government. And I say regarding the NFUS, it's our understanding that they've got comfort that it's excellent. Can the government just confirm that that's the case? I'm sure it is.
Yeah,
otherwise,
absolutely.
We wouldn't have said it.
It would be along those lines.
That's sufficient, is it not, Alistair? I'm just asking.
Yeah,
I've got to go, actually.
I mean, that's fine. It's an ideal moment to introduce controversy. We've all had to go. But I think that I'm happy with that approach, as long as we kind of draw that distinction, that we're not trying to suggest that a bill has been shown to third parties.
No, it just, you know, in the response it says they stated that the forthcoming agriculture bill would offer the adequate.
Yeah.
So if they've been given reassurances, it would be good for the committee to be given those reassurances too.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Okay. So if we're content to note that. Secondly, we have the Seed Fees Scotland Amendment Regulation 2023. Do any members wish to make any recommendations on this instrument? No. And lastly, we have the feed additive, former provisional authorisation, Cobalt 2 compound, Scotland Regulations 2023. Do any members have any recommendation on this instrument? I think in this instance, I think this we have this in front of us because there was a failure to apply for appropriate licence within the time, which has led to this SSI coming forward. I did have concerns that given this was an animal health situation, why the Minister for Women's and Public Health was actually the Minister to make the decision. But I have been informed that it's the Food Safety Scotland who deal with this, and that sits within her portfolio. So if everybody's content, yes. That concludes our meeting in public, and we now move into private session.